those who appreciate the work that we're doing here on Standing for Truth, please hit that subscribe button, because we are just getting started.
Okay, looks like we are live. We love that trailer. We are going to play it as many times as we can for a good laugh. But this is our second episode in the Another Evolutionist Bites the Dust series. Be sure to check out Vice Rhino. It was a lot of fun. There's no way he's going to be able to respond. And there's no excuse given to not responding, because any of us in here are happy to debate him. Happy to debate any of the evolutionists that we demolish in this series. So this one's going to be a lot of fun. You can see here, quick announcement, a couple announcements actually. Monday, we are going to be interviewing Dr. Rob Carter, one of our favorites. We've learned a lot from him. So it's an honor. We have a lot of respect for him. It's going to be a lot of fun. Evidence for biblical creation, Adam and Eve, the first couple. So we're going to be asking some of the best questions. We're going to be debunking the critics. Next Friday, we're going to have Dr. Rob Stadler. There's his two new books there, both awesome. The Stairway to Life, The Scientific Approach to Evolution. So he's going to be on here. Brother John Maddock has interviewed him. So Professor Dave, he's recently turned down a debate, actually for the second time. So what's that sound a chicken makes, right? But so we're going to have Dr. Stadler on Friday. And Professor Dave, you put out a video recently trying to defend the indefensible abiogenesis, and he put out a rebuttal to Dr. James Tour. So it's going to be a lot of fun, because Dr. Stadler, absolute genius. We're going to go through Professor Dave's video line by line, sentence by sentence, and refute it. So like I said, tonight we are exposing Aron Ra, as you can see on the screen there. He's the next victim, and it's going to be specifically on human evolution. This series, to be honest with you, can last the next million years. You know, deep time, as evolution would say, because we got a ton of videos that we are going to be getting to. So we got some good people with us today. I should say tonight. And I also want to say thanks for your patience in the audience. It's definitely going to be worth the wait. Brother Nephilim Free says, Aron Ra gets smoked again. Yeah, this is going to be fun. There's no coming back from this one. So let's see. We got Nephilim Free, Jason, Ra, Matt, Praise. Gentlemen, thanks for being here. How's everybody doing?
Good. It's always a pleasure.
Shalom.
Awesome. Matt, are you excited about Monday or what? We got some good questions for Dr. Carter, don't we?
Yeah, that's going to be awesome. I mean, you talk about somebody that really likes to answer the questions that the critics say that there are no answers to. Well, guess what? We got the guy. So
exactly. Yeah, exactly. So all of those questions that apparently Dr. Dan says we haven't answered, even though we've answered it over and over again, we're going to have Dr. Carter himself, who's worked extensively on the HapMap data. As far as I'm concerned, he's an expert when it comes to mitochondrial DNA, Y chromosome, molecular clocks. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Yeah. So why don't we get right into it tonight? We're going to be debunking Aron Ra. Like I said, so we've got a video as well that we are going to go through, as we always do, the same thing we did with Vice Rhino. We took out the important parts of his video on human evolution, and we're going to tackle it. All of us here, we got good presentations, slides, good information to show you guys. So I think everyone's going to have a lot of fun. If there's specific questions in the audience, let us know. We'll try and be as interactive as possible, but I'm looking forward to this. A lot of fun. Any other words from you gentlemen before we get going?
Oh, I'm ready to kill it. Let's do it.
Rock and roll.
No, go. Yeah, go.
Okay. I'm going to screen share then. We're going to start off with a video that I did not put in the presentation. So here we go. Okay, full screen. Make sure everybody can hear. And here we go.
He doesn't know the scientists, or he doesn't understand the explanation the science gave. Therefore, God, therefore his book, Fairy Tales, which we have conclusively disproved on every point. We know that there was no Adam and Eve. Other Christians are declaring this now. Francis Collins, who's the director of the Human Genome Project, he announced there cannot be an Adam and Eve. Genetically, it's impossible. It did not exist. We know the Tower of Babel didn't happen. We know what really happened and what it's based on. Likely. We know that the global flood of Noah's Ark did not happen. I've got an eight-part video series explaining the different ways, the different types of science that proves that never happened.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that. I just will have a book out on that for everybody as well, debunking every single word he says in every one of those videos for those of you that are interested. But we must go back to the very first statement that he made, okay, everybody? And it is the definitive fact that there could not be an Adam and Eve. So one more time.
Therefore, this book, Fairy Tales, which we have conclusively disproved on every point. We know that there was no Adam and Eve. Other Christians are declaring this now. Francis Collins was the director of the Human Genome Project. He announced there cannot be an Adam and Eve.
There you have it, people. What do you think?
Whoever wants to find somebody who already believes in evolution. I mean, duh. You know, he's not going to cite sources that are disagreeing with him.
Yeah. Well, what's funny is it just shows how out of date Aron Ra is, because Francis Collins, Dr. Dennis Venema, the main argument that they use to say that there's been no Adam and Eve is what they say is the human diversity that we see today. There's too much, okay? Because remember, even though they're theistic evolutionists, they say, they're assuming that mutations are the ultimate source of all genetic variety. So they say, according to mutation, so they're assuming universal common descent and the genetic mechanisms to take their fish to fishermen, they're assuming that, when in fact, creationists, we propose front-loaded genetic diversity. So that argument is only legit if you assume that mutations are the source for all DNA variety, when time is not required for the diversity today, because as we know, diversity can be designed and built into Adam and Eve. One thing I'll say, Dr. Joshua Swamidas, he used to work for BioLogos, and he's not the only one. A lot of theistic evolutionists have come out against Dr. Francis Collins and said, yeah, you know, it's not a very good argument they're using, because from a creationist starting point, why would God design Adam and Eve homogeneous? Obviously, when God said, be fruitful and multiply, he didn't want that to be carried out through cloning. So right. Front-loaded genetic diversity makes sense.
Yeah, God didn't want us all to be clones. The real ticker is the time. You know, the evolutionists believe this kind of genetic variation can be had over millions of years, but not created. So their problem really is with creation. It's not with science, because science supports us. The problem they really have is with creation. So they believe that kind of diversity can be produced by millions of years of genetic mutation, but they refuse to believe that the diversity is possible from a creation standpoint, especially in only 4,500 years since the flood. But as we're going to show, genetic diversity can be organisms can show incredible diversity and rapidly, as you show on the screen with your picture of dogs. Now, the evolutionist will say, well, that's intended. That's made by man. That's selective breeding. Well, organisms produce this kind of variety by natural breeding selections and not just by selective breeding in the wild. Look how many different varieties of crickets and grasshoppers there are. I mean, right. It's just amazing.
Well, you and I, Neff, we were talking, I think it was just a couple of weeks ago, we were on Otangelo's channel, and there was a theistic evolutionist there. Remember, he kept challenging us on all these questions. You know, are there too many DNA differences to explain from two people over 6,000 years? He asked questions about speciation, ERVs, chromosome 2 fusion, and we gave him very sufficient answers. He had no rebuttal. We actually, I think, got him to got him to think. But yeah, it's funny. From their starting point, they assume that the origin of all genetic diversity is mutations, when we know that mutations are detrimental, they're deleterious, they are the destroyer, not the creator. But what's funny is someone like Aron Ra would just say, oh, this is a post hoc ad hoc rescue device. Well, he's not up to date on the creationist literature, the testable predictions that are coming out from creationists, because if the vast majority of our genome is the result of created heterozygosity, for example, and these DNA elements like ERVs, retrotransposons, ALUs, pseudogenes, if they are also the result of divine creation at the initial creation event, then we would predict function. And that's exactly what we're seeing. For example, paper after paper, you can see here, far from being junk DNA, the pervasive retrotransposons that populate the genome have a powerful capacity to influence genes and chromatin. We've got intronic ALUs that influence alternative splicing. And I'm guessing Aron Ra, he's not up to date on this literature. Look at this, scientists identify new beneficial function of endogenous retroviruses in immune response. Orphan genes are these sequences of DNA, as you can see down here, that code for proteins, but guess what? They have no apparent relatives. How does Aron Ra, how does he explain the existence of orphan genes? And if he's gonna say de novo gene synthesis, well, give us some empirical evidence in the lab. And as you can see here, I mean, we can go on all day regarding the functional benefits of introns and genomes. Plus it makes testable predictions on speciation rates, mutation rates. Matt, what do you think? Real quick, before we move on, why don't you give us some thoughts on molecular clocks, mitochondrial DNA? We just put out a book on that. So what are your thoughts on that, brother?
I would like to first point out that when he says it's our model that's making the retrodictions, and it's completely opposite. You see, their model is the one that made retrodiction. They predicted that the fossil record was true, so they invented the phylogenetic method, which is nothing but an assumption. Then they made a prediction based on that. It was wrong. So then they invented their bottleneck theory to cope with the three pieces of evidence. One, the fast mutation rates. Two, the few total fixations that exist in the whole population. And three, the most important one, is the low genetic diversity between all people. So therefore, they had to invent a genetic bottleneck to account for all this horrible things that came against them. So it's their retrodiction that failed them, not ours.
Well, what's funny is when it comes to diversity, so they want to use this argument about genetic, oh, there's too much genetic diversity to explain if we all descended from just two people. Well, here's the thing. If God really did create Adam and Eve and we did descend from just two people thousands of years ago, we would expect, like you said, Matt, we would expect what? Low genetic diversity in human beings today. But if deep time evolution were true, and if Aron Ra watches this, and he's probably going to have a tear roll down his cheek because he's not going to be able to refute it, but if he is willing to give an answer, if deep time evolution were true, as Aron proposes, and we've been accruing genetic mistakes for millions of years, we would expect high levels of genetic diversity. But yet what we see in human genetic diversity is low genetic diversity, which this data confirms the biblical creation expectations. Then we have the evidence for the one Y chromosomal ancestor, one mitochondrial DNA ancestor. This was all expected. This was all predicted if the biblical creation story found in Genesis is true. But when the data was discovered in genetics, the evolutionists, like you said, it was retrofitted into their story. Now, what I like to point out is the fact that this data had to be true if biblical creation is true. It didn't have to be true for evolution to be true. But the fact that it came true, that this is the evidence that we see, suggests that it's far more consistent with a biblical creation model. And as always, the evolutionists had to post hoc, ad hoc, rationalize it, force fit the data into their story. So they're constantly, constantly not predicting these things. You know, they always say deep time evolution is predictable. And in fact, Matt, we know they're constantly retrofitting the data to fit their story.
I'd like to point out something for the audience. They might hear us talk about things about low genetic diversity amongst man. And at the same time, they may hear us talking about the tremendous variety in various creatures, including man. I want them to understand that even though the genetic diversity in mankind is very limited and far less than what the evolutionist expects. A very small difference in genetic information can result in a great difference in the variety. For example, there's low genetic diversity in human beings compared to what the evolutionist expects. But look at the tremendous variation that is a product of that small difference in genetics in humankind. We've got these various tribes of mankind, and they're morphologically somewhat different. The shapes of our skulls, the muscularity of the calves or the buttocks, the length of the jaw, various differences in mankind that are easily apparent. You can look at the various tribes of man and see tremendous difference, but that tremendous difference is a product of a very small amount of genetic information difference. And so I wanted the audience not to be confused,
because
it might sound like we're contradicting ourselves when we talk on one hand about low genetic diversity in mankind and the tremendous variety of animals have been able to produce since the flood, including men. But that's not a contradiction. You have to understand that a small amount of genetic change can produce remarkable differences in us. So when we mention low genetic diversity, what we're talking about is compared to what the evolutionist would expect the genome to have acquired over a period of hundreds of thousands of years, if not more, possibly 1.5 million years, is very, very small compared to what their theory would predict. And that shows young Earth creation and shows mankind has been around just for thousands of years.
Amen.
Not hundreds of thousands of years.
Exactly. I want to touch on one point there. And it seems like we're spending a lot on this one issue, but that's a major claim Aron Ra is making, that, you know, Adam and Eve has been disproven, as we're showing that he's just clearly not up to date on the data. What you said there, Neff, was brilliant. The fact is, every single human being, we're 99.9% similar. And actually, when you look at people around the world, there are only about, and Dr. Carter talks about this, you're going to see him talk about this on Monday, but there's only about 10 million variants. Okay, that are found, more or less, I should say. Now, these are common. They're also, for the most part, not disease-causing. Okay, now, evolutionists want to call these mutations. But guess what? This is an assumption on their part, when in fact, these could have certainly been the variants that God engineered into Adam. Because when you're looking at alleles, okay, what's created, what's mutation? Well, that which is common, okay, and not disease-causing and functional, to some extent, would be that which is created. Now, the ones that are rare, right, those would be mutations post-flood, post-Babel. But what's funny is you and I, let's say me and Neff, we have about 3 million places, okay, about 3 million places where the copy we got from our mother differs from the copy we got from our father. So if we carry 3 million differences, it's not a huge stretch at all to say that Adam would have carried the 10 million, the common variants that we see around the world. Because remember, we only carry a subset, okay, of the world's diversity. Now, put the world's diversity into Adam, and over time, what happens? Those genetic variants spread out. Those 10 million variants I'm talking about, you can find them all around the world. You can find them in Europe, China, Africa. And the reason this is because those variants were what? They were in our population before we spread out. This means those variants were on the ark, and ultimately this means they were in Adam. I always say we have traces of Babel, traces of Adam, traces of Eve in our genetics.
Absolutely. And at the Tower of Babel affair, mankind would have already diversified a little bit in the various early examples of what would later become the various tribes of mankind. If you study history and going back into as far as we can see in real human history, the first couple of centuries after the Tower of Babel affair, we've already got the basis for all the tribes of mankind. We know that Ham migrated into Africa, and he became the father of African people. And we've got Japhet migrating into Europe and becoming the father of the European peoples, and et cetera, like this. And Gomer migrating into Asia. So already, and within a couple of hundred years after this,
That's weird.
Right, and within a couple of hundred years after the Tower of Babel affair, you've already got man has diversified into the basic tribes of mankind, and those would have become more and more pronounced over the following few centuries. It doesn't take long to produce that kind of variety. It didn't take long, and that's because of the built-in heterozygosity, the that's ability right. To create variation built into the genome of man, and it was in Noah when he got off the ark.
Well, that's a brilliant point. And one thing I want to say off of that, it's related, but he wants to say, oh, there's no evidence for Adam and Eve. And yet what we can see here is the genetic diversity is perfectly explained and only explained from the biblical creation starting point. But they're the ones that are constantly retrofitting.
I can't hear anything.
Oh, Jason, are you?
Is that just me or?
No, we can hear.
Let me put it on my computer.
Jason, if you want to leave the studio and then come back in, it should work. Well, I guess if he can't hear, he's not going to be able to. If I kick him out and allow him to come back on, is that going to ban him? Praise? No, I can kick him out and he can make his way back in, right? Okay, here. Yeah, okay. So he can come back in and it should work. He might just have to refresh. So as I was saying there, the there's something called the HapMap project. Okay, I did an entire video where I kind of talked about the genetics here, refuting Dr. Dan, and I went into the HapMap data, and I've asked over and over again for the evolutionists to address this data, and they refuse to because they can't. So Dr. Carter, once again, he's going to talk about this on Monday. Now this, just so people aren't confused, it was a project, and the intention of the project was to compile a significant fraction of human genetic diversity, okay, since we're on the diversity topic. They examined millions of variants in thousands of people from around the world, and they actually made the data easily available. So Dr. Carter, he's analyzed this, and what he found was the human genome, there's evidence that it was young, because there's shared blocks of DNA that are large, meaning there has not been enough time to scramble them to randomness. Now, my question to Aron Ra, he won't be able to answer this, is why are there so many large linkage blocks found in the human genome? This speaks of the youthfulness of the genome, because we know processes like recombination, gene conversion, okay? This scrambles those linkage blocks, for example. And if we've been evolving for millions of years, okay, and even if they want to look to like recombinational hotspots or population bottlenecks, it's still not going to explain the data, because the DNA of humans should be a lot more scrambled than it is. Now, the reason why it's not so scrambled, even though recombination gene conversion exists, is because the human genome is young and there has only been 6,000 years of scrambling and not hundreds of thousands to millions of years. So we'll see if he can answer that. I doubt it. One other thing he noticed too was that most blocks of DNA are actually shared among all world populations, meaning the human population came from a single source, and evidence for the human genome falling apart. Deletions, Dr. Carter points out, tend to not be shared among populations, but they're unique to subpopulations. Once again, evidence for the youth of the genome, and that we came from a single source population in the recent past. So when he just says Adam and Eve has been disproven, he's out of date, maybe he's lying, he's working from an assumption of universal common ancestry, but that is 100% false. Go ahead, guys.
Jason, you're up, man.
Oh, Jason's on mute.
Jason.
I've had stuff. Hang on, I'm just gonna stop this. I've just had a few things going on here that I've had to deal with. So,
you can hear us now, Jason.
Oh yes. Sorry, yeah. I can. Oh, I was on mute the whole time before or what?
You were. And no problem. We just want to keep this flowing nicely. So if you had a point you wanted to make before we moved on, go ahead.
No. I missed the most of it because I got cranky with my dog and locked him up because he was annoying me.
No problem.
He always does it when I'm live, so that's why I missed it. So he's locked up now, so he won't be able to annoy me anymore.
Now, Neff, I noticed that Aron Ra there, he said, oh, the global flood's also been disproven. Well, we've given many lines of evidence from genetics and our genome directly that takes us back to the flood, right? What are your thoughts? I mean, you're kind of our flood expert. What are your is that true? Has the global flood been disproven?
Quite the opposite. The amount of evidence for the flood is just absolutely incredibly overwhelming. The physical, geological, geomorphological evidence of the flood is it's astonishing. And you've probably heard me talk a lot about it, but I've only given a sliver of the actual geological evidence for the flood. There is a tremendous number of features of the Earth that can only be explained by the global flood, including the formation of the so-called geologic column, the sedimentary strata with fine distinct boundaries and particle size distribution, unconformities and paraconformities, folded strata and deformed strata in mountains, which many of which contain fossils, by the way, proving that they couldn't have been formed deep inside the Earth where the heat is great enough to deform rock. The massive subduction, the fact that plates do subduct could only happen rapidly. If it happened very slowly, one would simply slide up under the other one. But they've been shoved deep down inside the Earth. That's got to happen with a tremendous amount of energy behind it, rapidly. It can't be explained by plates moving at the rate your fingernails grow. It's not going to turn south and go deep inside the Earth that way. It's not going to happen. The gravity of the Earth going downward makes the materials too compact. They resist too much. Cold slabs, I call them cold, you know what I mean, deep inside the Earth, the volcanic eruptions and intrusions from the surface of the Earth, the list goes on and on and on of things that disprove the global flood is a geological fact. I would love to debate Aron Ra about that subject. Of course, he won't debate me about anything, but if he did, it would be an absolute embarrassment. So his statement that the flood has been disproved is just evolutionist jargon and shenanigans. Most loud, outspoken evolutionists like himself don't like to take on somebody about the flood in an actual debate, structured debate, because they're afraid of allowing the audience to actually hear the geological evidence of the flood because they can't refute it. So most of those guys like Aron Ra are actually afraid to debate the global flood in a structured debate.
That's right. That's it. Especially when it comes to a debate where equal time is agreed upon, for example, where Aron Ra can't just talk over us, right? Because what I find when it comes to the flood is his only argument is, well, I've got this, you know, whatever part series that you can go and watch, which has already been addressed. It's already been refuted. And we always talk about how the gold standard of science is to make testable predictions. And you just brought up the cold slab. So I would challenge Aron Ra to provide us better predictions when it comes to uniformitarianism and tell us why it was possible for Dr. John Baumgartner, okay, to suggest that, hey, if my catastrophic plate tectonics model is indeed true and the global flood indeed did happen, and plates, because we read in the Bible that the fountains of the great deep or broken open plates would be moving horizontally, they'd be moving vertically. Now, if the plates are being pushed down, they obviously haven't had time to melt, according to our model, if it happened just 4,500 years ago.
Well, just imagine, brother, you're pushing a massive slab of material into the Earth at the rate your fingernails grow. That's right. Uniformitarian geology, right? Are you expecting us to believe that pushing a gigantic slab of the Earth's crust, oceanic crust, down into the Earth at the rate your fingernails grow, it's not going to continuously warm up to the temperature of the materials around it?
Exactly.
Over millions of years? That's absolutely nonsense.
It's nonsense. And Neff, how come every time you ask somebody in a debate, whether it's RJ Downard, whether it's whoever it is, I mean, you've had a number of debates on the flood. Every time I've asked the question, they can never answer. They'll say, well, what was the temperature, right? That's typically the response. They always ignore the fact that it was also a testable prediction, okay, that these massive slabs of cold rock that are found at the base of the mantle, which means they've only been pushed there recently, and since they haven't melted, obviously, if uniformitarianism is true, they should be a lot more hot or even melted. Now, the thing is, this is a huge confirmation of the global flood model that Aron Ra says has been disproven. And it's a testable prediction. Does he have any of his own? How does he address the data? I mean, what are your thoughts?
Yeah. Well, I mean, he doesn't like to address it. That's the thing. You don't really hear, you know, I don't really follow Aron Ra, but I've watched quite a few videos of his. And you don't really hear him talking about the flood except to say it's a myth, you know. But he doesn't really talk about geological evidence for the flood to speak of. He just claims that the strata were created over vast ages of time, as a good uniformitarianist would do. But he doesn't really get into the nuts and bolts of the flood because, firstly, I think he really doesn't know enough about geology or about the subject to get into it deeply. And so he's afraid to go there because he just doesn't know enough. So, he centers pretty much everything he talks about on the alleged evolution of man and paleoanthropology and phylogenetics. That's his big deal. That's all he ever really talks about. He just goes on and on and on about paleoanthropology and phylogeny, and because he thinks that's the killer for everything the creationist believes. Right. But I got news for him. You know, there's a lot more to it than that.
Well, what's funny is, as you can see, we only went through like a couple sentences that he said, but someone like Aron Ra, he says more things wrong in one sentence than words are in that sentence.
Absolutely.
It takes us a half an hour to go through it. So
it is amazing how many wrong things a guy can say in a 45-minute video, really.
That's what, exactly. And we like to dissect everything. So let's see. The two claims, and we'll move on, was Adam and Eve have been disproven. Clearly have not. Let's see if you can address anything we said. Secondly, he says the global flood has been disproven. Clearly not. So, if you want, we can move on unless someone else has anything to add. We can see what his next wrong thing is that he says.
Yeah, one thing I thought I'd share it with you guys. He also, if you go to his video, How Archaeology Disproves Noah's Flood, he states young earth creationism rejects the date of the flood as indicated by Usher's chronology in 1491 BC arbitrarily because they know that it's impossible and they're intellectually dishonest. Hmm. Well, first of all, that's completely wrong. And then here's the other thing that he says. He says that Usher said that Exodus, Aron Ra believes that the flood landed on this date, he states, by Usher's chronology, right? So he's completely wrong.
That's laughable.
With a little bit of study, and he would have realized that on Rational Wiki, they state that that's the date for Exodus. He didn't even get the right date right in his very first comment that he made.
It's time for him to retire.
Man, talk about zero critical thinking skills. I mean, you think he would cross-reference something. I mean, even his own source.
He calls doesn't
talk about the flood from a geological standpoint. He talks about it from other standpoints. You know, paleontology proves it wrong. Human history proves it wrong. But he won't get into the nuts and bolts of the geology of it with anybody because I think he's afraid of that and really doesn't know enough to do it.
He will never debate you, Neff, on the flood. I guarantee it. We can challenge him right now. Equally timed, respectful debate. He won't do it. And Matt knows what. Like you said, he's trying to use indirect evidence. He won't engage the geology. One of his main arguments, Matt, you know, is what? Dendrochronology, right? He's got a whole video on that.
Yeah.
And what are your thoughts on that one? I mean, that one's been destroyed over and over again. You've got a specific section of it in your book.
Yeah. Matter of fact, because he spent an entire video series on it, what I found pretty funny is when I went on the Non Sequitur show and to talk about it, he goes, "No, well, I don't talk about that subject." But you're comfortable to make
right.
feel on it. That doesn't even make sense. You're comfortable enough to say that you know it well enough to teach people the subject, but you're not well enough equipped to actually talk about it with me. It's not even a debate. They literally just called us cowards and told us to come on the show.
Yeah.
I joined. And then they didn't even want to talk to me about it.
It's a smokescreen. That's all it is. His blather is a smokescreen. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. They didn't want to talk about the science. Remember? He said, "Oh, I already debunked their video." And then they said, "Well, what about the PAX6 gene?" He goes, "I've never heard of it." It was the first 6 seconds of the video I made. So just ridiculous. Anyway, like you said, we should probably move on. We got a whole video to debunk. If you guys are ready.
Yeah, go.
Okay.
Let's do it.
All right, here we go.
If they would quit saying so many things wrong in two sentences, we could get this done in 30 minutes. Vice Rhino, we tackled his arguments for what? 3 hours. See, the thing is, these guys, these big dogs, they don't think we're going to come together. Bunch of us informed, well-studied creationists and dissect every word they say, which is why they don't want to debate informed creationists. They want to find somebody who only knows the basics, right? Aron Ra is notorious for this, and just bully them. Because he was able to get away with saying there's no evidence for the flood, there's no evidence for Adam and Eve, but if it were one of us, we would have absolutely corrected his errors with those statements.
Yeah, well, they've had their run on YouTube for long enough. They hate us. We're here to stay. So. Oh.
Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone. And another one gone. Another one bites the dust. Hey.
In the Disney cartoons, everyone knows that Mickey is a mouse and Donald is a duck, and you probably understand that even if we never heard their last names. But people often get confused about what Goofy is supposed to be. According to Disney, Goofy is a dog, and he looks as much like a real animal as Mickey or Donald do. The reason Goofy doesn't look like a dog to us is because Pluto is a dog too, but Pluto only has the behavior of a dog, and that creates a conceptual disconnect when we try to understand how Goofy and Pluto can both belong to the same species. This may be one reason why many people have a problem trying to understand how humans can be classified as a subset of the family of apes. But however one defines what a human is, that definition has to begin with the biology of an ape, onto which we may add our uniquely specific traits.
For our listeners, Chris, when you say genus homo, you're talking about modern human, or what are you talking about exactly?
That's it. That's the question I'm trying to get at. Exactly. So they'll say that the earliest members of the genus homo are the earliest primitive humans that are starting to make more and more like us. That's kind of a vague way of saying, I guess. But here's the key. Because they believe that there should not be... So from that position, they believe you should not find any anatomically modern-looking bones older than 2.5 million years old. Mm. Imagine if they found stone tools, footprints fossilized in ash, for example, human-looking bones, partial human skeletons. Imagine if they have really a growing amount of evidence that shows we can find anatomically modern human-looking bones predating the origin of genus Homo. If we could find that, that would effectively qualify the ape-to-man theory. Mm. Although, it's kind of like, here's an analogy. You can obviously coexist with your grandparents, but you can't be born before your grandparents. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, completely.
You can't have humans existing before they supposedly evolved, but yet we are finding, we document this in chapter 11, if the chapter's called coexistence, we find clear evidence of human bones, partial skeletons, footprints, human artifacts predating the origin of genus of the first humans.
So you're essentially saying they're putting the cart before the horse. Rather than allowing the evidence to inform their theory, they're allowing their theory to inform their evidence.
Yes. And here's the key. So when they find these human-looking bones, they understand anatomy. They're experts in anatomy. So they can acknowledge this looks human in this respect. And they have certain terms to describe it, primitive or derived. Putting that aside for now, keeping things straightforward, even though they'll acknowledge and they'll say this one is anatomically indistinguishable from modern Homo sapiens, they'll even say virtually identical to Homo sapiens. They'll use that kind of language. Even though they acknowledge the anatomy is clearly modern human, because of the theory, just like you're saying, they have to say, well, it just proves that Australopithecus were bipedal. They must have had very human-looking bones. They must have had very human-looking features, because that's how evolution happened. It happened in a mosaic fashion, where certain parts evolved before others, certain skeletal parts. So that's amazing. Yeah. So as a Christian, we're trying to say, wait a second, let's just look at the anatomy. Let's just use the real observational science. Let that guide our, instead of force-fitting the data.
Yeah.
And what you come to is a conclusion that is very biblical. Apes and humans coexisted as far back as stone fossils are found, and that's consistent with Genesis. So the Bible teaches that God created man and apes on the same day of the creation. Mm. So the fossil record remarkably fits that pattern.
The study of physical anthropology has many points of confusion, regardless of one's level of education or
acceptance. Want to pause it there, Matt?
Yep.
Yeah, so some thoughts I would have based on what Roop was saying there. That's Christopher Roop. Him and Dr. Sanford wrote the book, Contested Bones. Actually, you know what? Maybe I should screen share on a couple papers here. And then as I'm doing that, unless someone had any comments on like Matt, what would be your thoughts on Aron Ra's claims about apes? See, that they constantly want to look at like the morphology, the physiology, the genetics, the anatomy, and point out that humans are apes. In the same way that clearly, based on characteristics, okay, we are mammals, we are vertebrates, we are eukaryotes. This in no way, shape, or form proves that every single mammal on this planet is related, or every single eukaryote, a whale and a pine tree, are related through common ancestry. No, of course, when it comes to the biological world, God would have created some creatures that are more similar to other creatures and also less similar to other creatures. And it turns out we share more in terms of morphology, physiology, and anatomy with the apes, with the chimpanzees, with the bonobos, for example, the gorillas, the orangutans. Therefore, we're going to share more in terms of genetics. Is it any surprise that we share more in genetics, morphology, you name it, with a chimp than we do with a fish or a bacteria? You know, this is just common sense. That nested hierarchical, those patterns we see in the biological world is just reflective of God's hierarchical nature. That's why we constantly point to the differentiating lines of evidence, which we've named a few already. DNA function, for example, molecular clock data. And one that I like to point out, because they like to focus on the similarities, right? When in fact, and I'll quote Dr. Jeffrey Tompkins here, he says many similar genes between humans and chimps are expressed very differently, and the expression profiles bear no signs of selection or having been evolved. Answer this question, Aron Ra, if you're ever watching this. Genes associated with brain, cell transport, cell signaling, testes, and many metabolic functions show distinctly different expression levels between humans and chimps. These genes occur in elaborate networks, and not only must be precisely coordinated within these networks, but also between organs all over the body. In addition, many expressed genes in humans are not even found in chimps. Research has clearly shown a pattern of incredible irreducible complexity in the genome that appears suddenly and fully integrated in humans, totally distinct from chimpanzees. So Aron Ra wants to ignore the differences and focus on the similarities, which, as a matter of fact, we would expect based on common design, and you would also expect based on common ancestry. But the differentiating lines of evidence is what shows sufficiently that humans are their own created kind. There's no way around it. Thoughts, guys?
Well, yeah, the you look at apes, and like when they grow, as they grow from an infant or from a fetus to an infant to an adolescent, and look at the changes in their skulls, and like you can get a chimpanzee when it's a fetus or a newborn, and look at the skull, and it looks very human-like. It's only as it gets older it starts to grow out. So, you know, you've got these animals in the thing when they're trying to compare. It's like similarities, like you're talking about similarities when they're trying to compare skulls that they've found in the ground. It's a bit ridiculous because they've got all these different sized skulls and these different skulls, but some of them could be the same species, like they're arguing with Homo erectus and things like that. So it's just these similarities that they see are just ridiculous. It's variation in nature that we see all the time. We see it today. We've seen it in recent human history.
Yes, we have seen it in recent human history. Standing, when you get ready, if you're going to talk about the Toley footprints, I have a brief, very brief, it's only a matter of seconds, video that I want to screen share with it about the Toley prints that is, I think you'll find very interesting, the audience.
Actually, I just wanted to share a screen to show a paper here by Donald Johansson, just like confirming what Roop was saying here. As you can see here, the collection suggests that Homo and Australopithecus coexisted as early as 3 million years old. Now, here's what I want to point out, okay? And this has been the argument from, you know, even your Gutsick Gibbon, your Aron Ra. What they'll say is, they have to tap out and admit, okay, this is what the evidence suggests. Australopithecines, you know, our so-called ancestors, and the Homo genus coexisted. But they'll say, you know, we can coexist with our ancestors in the same way that, you know, the domestic dog, which obviously ultimately descended from wolves, but yet they still exist with wolves. But here's the problem. Here's the problem. If human species are existing at the exact same time or even before, as Roop was suggesting, we may be able to live with our grandparents, our parents, even our great-grandparents, but we cannot live with our great-great-great-great-grandparents. Now, the fact that we see all of the Homo species, right, your Homo variants, Neanderthals, Naledi, Floresiensis, Luzonensis, Erectus, you know, you name it, and also the Australopithecines, all coexisting at the exact same time, intermingling, for example, with the Homo genus, we've interbred. Well, this is exactly what we'd expect from biblical creation. Once again, we don't need to retrofit the data like the evolutionists are constantly doing, rescue device after rescue device. After the ark, you've got some Australopithecines. You'd obviously have humans as well. Humans congregated in Babel. Let's say there's about 1,000 of them. While the animal kinds would have actually migrated around the earth, right? Now, here's the thing. And that's why, you know, sometimes you will find the ape species a little earlier. Well, that's because they migrated earlier. But here's the thing. This perfectly fits, and it's perfectly consistent with our model. So I want to point out, a lot of people in the audience, a lot of kids, they're not taught. They're just taught that, you know, we evolved from Lucy. The Australopithecines are our ancestors, but they're never taught that, no, we coexisted with the Australopithecines. And one of the lines of evidence are the Laetoli footprints. And I'll hand it over to Neff to cover that, brother.
Well, they're never given any of the information that, that argues against or calls into question what the evolutionists say, but much less refutes it. So let me play this little brief video, if I can screen share something. It's really brief. Show you what this.
Yeah, just let us know when you're ready.
There we go. Okay, I should be screen sharing now. So, on my behalf, there we go. I hope you can hear it. This is a paleoanthropologist. An anthropologist to me, talking about the Laetoli footprints. Oh, wait a minute. You can't hear that, can you?
No.
Okay. So let me stop screen sharing. I think I forgot to
select. Yeah, you got to do the audio.
Yeah. Let me choose share audio and then start it again.
That's it.
Okay. There we go. Okay. Now, if you'll screen share me. There we go. Okay. So let's see if now you can hear.
On the other hand, when we compare the Laetoli print to that of a crime scene human print, they're virtually indistinguishable. The great toe is in line with the rest of the toes. What this has done in the human and the Laetoli print is to create an arch. And that's a hallmark of typical modern upright locomotion, because the arch is an energy absorber. And that's the kind of fine tuning that you would expect in a biped that had been that way for a very long period of time.
So there you have it. Were you able to hear that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So the Laetoli prints are distinctly human. That's it. The evolutionist claimed that they were ape-like. You know, they believe they attributed them to afarensis, but they are strictly human. There's nothing about them that looks ape-like at all. They even have an arch. You can see the arch in the footprint, and that's a distinctly human foot feature. You know, and he said, this anthropologist said, notice that the arch is, it shows a fine tuning. Now, he might believe in evolution, but he's refuting these Laetoli footprints as being evidence of they're not attributed, they can't be attributed to Afarensis, which is an alleged hominid ancestor of man. They can't be because they're strictly human and they have an arch. Notice he said that they would, this an arch like that in the foot is an example of what would be fine-tuning in the foot of a creature that had been that way for a very long time. So what he's saying is he believes evolution is true, and he believes the human arch was produced by the evolutionary fine-tuning over a very long period of time, hundreds of thousands of years, that produced the human foot. But what he's pointing out is that the Laetoli footprints are distinctly human. They're not attributable to Afarensis, as the evolutionists were claiming and Johansson was claiming 40 years ago. That argument from the evolutionists has been refuted by simply studying the footprints themselves.
Well, it's that was such a great video, such a fascinating point there, Neff. And that's why everything we see, okay, in all different fields of science, we now know it's confirmed the Australopithecines coexisted with humans, the Homo genus, of course. And when it comes to the molecular data, the genetic data, we've touched on orphan genes, linkage blocks, molecular clocks, DNA function, genetic diversity, you know, and we could go on and on. We've got video after video. And what's funny is if Aron Ra tries to refute this, he's not even going to realize that we've got 100 other videos refuting his refutations, because we've already torn apart all the critics' arguments. And as you can see here on the screen, he's always talking about the phylogeny challenge, right? Well, based on the things that I just said, especially DNA function and especially molecular clocks, we've been able to separate your human, your humankind, and your various ape kinds, right? Because he always wants to know, you know, name us a kind. Based on the number of lines of evidence that I just went over, that we've been going over and touching on, we can safely say that the Homo sapiens, right? And that's where you got these variants, right? Erectus, Neanderthal. You guys can see the slide, eh?
Yes.
Denisovans. Yeah, okay, good. The Hobbits, right? Homo floresiensis, for example. A lot of these, you can see that they've gone extinct. They've branched off, of course, from Babel, experienced accelerated genetic degeneration. Then, based on other forms of genetic data, you've got your chimp-like ancestor, of course, that would ultimately, the living apes today, bonobo and chimps, would descend from a created kind. Gorilla, especially based on like the Y chromosome, I'd ask Aron Ra how he explained the fact that the human Y chromosome and the chimpanzee Y chromosome are less than 70% dissimilar. And when you account for size differences and structure and overall architecture, it's like less than 35%. And they're so desperate that, Neff, you've seen what their answer was to that one. I mean, what are your thoughts? How much more rescue device can you get, right?
Well, their rescue devices are imaginary population genetics models that they fabricate in their head for the purpose designed, forward engineered for the purpose of trying to make an argument against the creation attributing fossils to a creature that don't, you know, that you can't look at the animal and specifically state that it's a particular species. It's kind of a mishmash of features, so they just throw them all into a single bag and right. Say somewhere in this bag is this creature that's an ancestor of man, and then they pick out the, well, we'll use this one and dig up some morgue bones. Hey, find me a finger bone. You know, I mean, that's not exactly what they're doing, but you get my drift. That's what they're right. Doing. They make a conglomerate of the collection of bones and fragments that they find, and they piece them together and fabricate an organism that they then claim is an ancestor of man. This is the kind of anthropology that these people are doing. They're also taking apes and declaring them to be less than an ape and more like a man. It all exists in the imagination of the evolutionist. It doesn't exist in the physical evidence.
Well, Neff, we always point out that they love their storyboards. And I've had so many discussions with these guys where you present the empirical data and the response is a 10-minute storyboard. We're not interested in storyboards. I tell my daughter and son two or three stories a night. You know, we've got a number of books, Cute Berenstain Bears, Arthur, Franklin. You know, I've had enough storyboard for one day. We want the science. Yeah. We want the empirical data. We don't want your storyboard. And that's why they can't address the data. I mean, look at this. More than 30% of the chimp Y chromosome lacks an alignable counterpart on the human Y chromosome and vice versa. And you should see the hoops that they have to jump through to explain why the overall architecture, the gene content is just all over the place when it comes to the chimpanzee Y, human Y, gorilla Y.
And two more things that really just throw a cog in their evolutionary machine, of course, is the studies have shown that the majority of single nucleotide variants that have occurred in the genome of mankind seem to have arisen in just the last 5 to 10,000 years. Now, that's impossible if evolution were true, right? Because if evolution were true, single nucleotide polymorphs are going to be happening continuously throughout history for every species that ever evolved, right? It couldn't be true that man would remain a Homo sapiens sapiens, which is modern humans, and they believe we have been for at least 200,000 years. Some will say for all, they keep pushing it back. Now there's some anthropologists are actually claiming we've been modern humans for over 1 million years. But, you know, to be safe, let's say 200 to 250,000 years minimum, right? Homo fully human. And then a virtual trickle, almost no single nucleotide variants occurring in man's genome until suddenly 5 to 10,000 years ago.
What a coincidence.
Stupid. And yeah, it does match the young earth model and the human genetic variation occurring after the Tower of Babel affair, right after the flood, a little more than 100 years after the flood. So it matches the creationists. Now they'll say 5 to 10,000 years. Well, we can give them a little playroom. They're gonna always have to, you know, stretch things around it. Their ideas are always made of rubber, so they stretch them any which way. They can believe that it's 5 to 10,000 years. For all I care, compare that to the young earth model and right. The after the flood model, after the Babel model, and compare that to the evolutionist. So it just can't scientifically be true that the majority of single nucleotide variations have occurred in man's genome only in the last 5 or 10,000 years, if man's been evolving for hundreds and hundreds of thousands of years. And also another thing is that 80% of the proteins in humans and chimpanzees are different by at least one amino acid, often several. Now, proteins are so incredibly uber specific. I mean incredibly specific, that a change caused by mutation in a single amino acid in a chain that would results in a protein can cause that protein to be less efficient at doing its job, which is a cause of disease, or completely dysfunctional. The protein is worthless. It does nothing. It's absolutely cell garbage. Now it's just clutter in the cell. And so that's how specific they are. If evolution were true, then 80% of the proteins between humans and chimps should be the same, not 80% different. It's the opposite of what evolution theory would predict. And then, of course, the worst part of it is, how do you get proteins to evolve by mutation anyway? That's a whole other argument. We could spend an hour on that, or 2 hours on that. Just not going to happen. Mutations simply can't be the mechanism that designed proteins. Proteins are complex information that's expressed to produce an outrageously fine-tuned, outrageously specific molecular component that is so specific in its shape and function and interdependencies with others that it simply can't be that random mutations designed proteins. No way. Can't be.
It's basically mutations kill us. Mutations kill us, and epigenetics changes us. And that's the, so they don't mutations don't change us. Epigenetics does.
Yeah, and guess what? The epigenetics suggests forward thinking. We got these built-in mechanisms that are there for rapid
5 million places.
Right,
5 million places. In the epigenome that they've discovered that 5 million different things that it can do, sort of thing. I mean, you know, to put it simply, it's incredible. I mean. It's just absolutely amazing, and that's coming from the evolutionists too, by the way.
Well, the fact that, like you said, Jason, brilliant point, we've got millions and millions of switches in our genomes just waiting to be turned on or off via environmental stimuli. So are the evolutionists, question to Aron Ra, how do your evolutionary mechanisms, natural selection, mutations, we don't want a storyboard, we've had enough storyboards, how do they build that which requires forward thinking? No, forward thinking mechanisms like epigenetics, redundancy, DNA repair mechanisms in the genome requires what? A forward thinker. Are they now going to suggest natural selection, which acts on the short term and not on the long term, are they going to suggest that these evolutionary processes have a mind? Because that's what they have to resort to.
That's right.
And here's what Brother Neff was talking about. 80% of proteins are different between humans and chimpanzee. The Y chromosome dissimilarity. I mean, he's got a lot to address. I just love, you're right, Neff. What a coincidence, right? Gene mutations began showing up in the last 5,000 years of human evolution. I want Matt to touch on this part because it's funny, eh, Matt? Because they'll point on some molecular clock studies that gave a date of like 10,000 or 12,000 years, when in fact they need their date to be 200,000 years or 150,000 years. How are they gonna get the mutation rates? Or the gene mutations that we see, how are they going to extend it that far? I mean, they're going to need really, really slow substitution rates. Or Matt, did you want to touch on that, brother?
Yeah, they require these mutation rates to slow down in the past, or they need them to be selected away, right? So they're always trying to slow this molecular clock down any way they possibly can. So they bring over a lot of pathetic studies, I call them, and they incorporate them and they pull them together with good studies, anything they can possibly do to slow the clock down. And they've done it. You know, they found studies where they've gone to islands and they've tested some inbred people and they found no mutations in them because selection removed the most harmful ones of all. And guess what? They were able to slow the clock down. Guess what? Just a couple thousand years. You know, just a few generations here and there. They can't push it back to their most recent bottleneck, even close. Even if they believe in the Toba bottleneck, the one that was about 75,000 years ago, which is highly controversial, and most of them don't even actually believe it. But let's just say that that was true. Well, guess what? The oldest ones that they can get with the actual observable data, assuming that these mutation rates that they get are seeing none of them are actually accurate, can only push it back thousands of years.
Unless they mix it with ape DNA.
Yeah, they basically love to use the phylogenetic method and mix it.
See, that's just total pseudoscientific crap.
Basically. Screen share me for a second, would you?
Yeah, let me...
Here we go. This is a reference. This is a similar reference to what probably the same paper that Standing for Truth was showing. They state, we estimate that approximately 73% of all protein coding SNVs and approximately 86% of all SNVs predicted to be deleterious arose in the past 5,000 to 10,000 years. Amazing. Now, here's another. This is from Discover Magazine. They say, most mutations in human genome are recent and probably harmful. Gee, probably harmful. Not helpful, huh? Joshua Key Aki of University of Washington recently explored the average age of species genome variants and said this, 3/4 of single nucleotide variants, a mutation that substitutes just one nucleotide in a long string of DNA, occurred within the past 5,000 years. Now, here's the kicker. This is where the evolutionist puts on their party hat. Surprising, considering that our species may be 200,000 years old.
Gee, that's surprising. We're supposed to be 200,000 years old.
Well, of course, it's surprising. Because if man has been 200,000 years old, fully modern humans, it can't be that most of the single nucleotide variants in our genome could have arisen in the last 5,000 to 10,000 years. But that could be true if Noah and his family got off the ark 4,500 years ago.
Have you noticed that they're always, I mean, I have dozens of papers where they're always surprised. This was unexpected. Now we have to resort to this rescue device or this rescue device or this storyboard and this storyboard. But apparently evolution is so predictable, but they're always, you know, shocked and surprised. So that's a brilliant, brilliant point. I want to point out, we got Brother Otangelo in here, absolute genius, warrior for Christ. You did an amazing job on Godless Engineer, Otangelo. So thanks for being here, brother. Did you have any thoughts? I know you've had some experience with Aron Ra, so Thanks for being here, brother.
Yes, I had some exchange with him on the YouTube comments on the channel, and it was very extended, and he blocked me everywhere, so I cannot have any contact with him anymore.
Are you talking about James Tour? If I were you on Tangelo, I would check out that some evolutionist hasn't photoshopped something that you've said and sent it to him or something, you know, because they've done that to other people. I'm not going to get into who and all the details, but that's the sort of thing they do. They're evil little mongrels, a lot of them, and they'll do stuff like that. So make sure that if you can get somebody to ask him to, you know, why? Do you know why he blocked you?
Well, he said that I lied about him, that I misrepresented him, because I said to him that he said that I claimed that his worldview is also faith-based, and he hates faith, you know.
Yeah, he does.
He says that faith, that his understanding of faith, that faith is always something which is baseless, which is blind, and we know that
really,
in the ultimately. Wow. Both the worldview of materialism and
that's
ours is based on faith, because we cannot have an understanding of ultimate reality. So
you can block me then too.
Well, not only that, the Bible describes faith. It defines this for us. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. So the scriptures describe faith not as blind, as atheists like to misrepresent it, but as evidentiary and substantiable. Isn't that amazing? So the very definition of Christian faith, according to the scriptures themselves, and what any Christian would testify to, is very much the opposite of what of atheists' way they represent it, as something blind, that you just blindly believe something without evidence or reason, you know.
Yes. SFT,
I can't believe that he's that much of a snowflake. I'm shocked. I'm absolutely shocked.
SFT, I've put a link here. Can you put it here so everyone can see it? It has to do in regards of comparison of the brain of chimps and humans.
Yeah, go ahead. Put it up.
Yeah, did you want to share it, Otangelo, or did you want us to share it?
I don't know how to share it. So if you can put it here, it's in the private chat, the link.
Oh, I see it. Right. Matt, did you want to screen share that real quick, or do you want me to? Let me see here.
Yeah, I'll get it.
Oh, my. I can do it, maybe. Let me check.
Watch. Yeah, if you got it pulled up, Otangelo, we'd like a rundown on that.
Okay. Here it is.
Oh, boom. Yeah. I'll approve it for you, and then you can boom. You're good, brother. Go ahead.
Let me just put it bigger so everyone can read it. So I made a little calculation here in regards of the size of the human brain and the chimp brain. And we have 1.5 quadrillion synapses, the human brain. And the chimp brain has a third of it. And then I made the calculation how many mutations that would have to occur in a time span of 3.5 million years, which is what they claim that then at that point the split occurred. So you would require 32,600 brain connections average per hour during 3.5 million years in order to have the difference which we see today. So how could that happen?
And Otangelo, that's an excellent point. Is that assuming as well that a single mutation could create a single synapse?
No, of course not. You need many more.
Yes, actually you would. You'd need numerous ones just to create a single synapse.
Right? I mean, a synapse and a neuron, these are tiny little computers in a literal sense. So that we are talking here about highest technology.
Yes.
And how you can have triple the size of a brain in 3.5 million years with trillions of synapses, that is absolutely beyond any reasonable.
Yeah. No, you'd probably need something like 10 or 20 or 30 or 50 billion years.
Oh, but well, it's terrible.
At the current rate, I mean, of mutations, I'm sorry.
Right. Was it Douglas Axe? I think it was, that showed to get a single functional fold in a protein would require a minimum of six mutations working in coercion with each other. And the time necessary for that is like more than the age of the Earth. just to get one. I mean,
just that's to get one
protein.
4.5 billion years.
You know, and proteins have numerous folds. You know, wow. A small protein, a typical protein, is 300 to 500 amino acids long. Some are thousands, but just 300. Imagine a 300 amino acid protein. There's boodles of folds in that. You know, and it's not just the amino acid folds in one direction. They roll and rotate and twist at angles when they fold too. That's another type of folding. So, it's not going to ever happen. It's rolling the dice and getting a six every time for a million years. You know, every time you do it, it's not going to happen.
Well, it's such good points from the both of you, and what you're saying there, Otangelo, is brilliant.
Yeah,
once again, great. like we've been doing since the beginning of this stream, we challenge Aron Ra to address these. And the thing is, we're showing the visuals, we're screen sharing. There's no excuse. We've got paper upon paper, all from the secular literature. And what's funny is Dr. Sanford, who he likes to scoff at, published a paper on the waiting time problem in a secular journal. It's been read by over 10,000 scientists. There's been no serious critique. The only critiques you get from the work of Dr. John Sanford is like blogs or like comments, but you never get any actual like peer-reviewed papers that are addressing Dr. Sanford's arguments. I mean, he spoke at NIH, National Institute for Health. You know, how many of them have done so? So people like Sanford don't even take these bloggers seriously. But in this paper, I'm going to give it, it's a really technical paper. I'll put in the description box afterwards. But what they did is they asked the question when it comes to human evolution, okay? They got about 6 million years since the split with humans and chimps. How long does it take to get two nucleotides in the genome? They were considering a pre-human population with a population size of about 10,000, okay? And these are extensive numerical simulations too. Mendel's accountant is amazing. So anyways, back to the point. So how long does it take to get two nucleotides in that genome and then switch them to two other nucleotides at the same location? This is what they say is the waiting time problem. So they conclude that if you're just waiting for a single mutation, okay, a single nucleotide change, and you're waiting for that change to take hold in the population and become selected to fixation. For the audience, fixation just means to get stuck, like literally be stuck, right, in the genome. We have fixed differences between the chimps and the humans. Now, it's very long to make a single specific nucleotide change. They showed in this paper about 1.5 million years. Now, the ape to man timeline is about 6 million years, like I said. So if you're waiting for a string of two, it takes 84 million years. If you're waiting for a string of three, okay, creating a new codon, changing an amino acid would take 376 million years, and it goes up from there. To get a string of eight, they conclude, which would just be like a short genetic word, you would need more, as Neff just said, you would need more time than the universe has had. And there's been no serious critique to this paper, but let's challenge Aron Ra. It's called the waiting time problem.
Okay, there is a YouTube video, which is What is the Evidence of Evolution? It has 3.7 million views. And Aron Ra, he has a synonym, and it is Angel Moo. And there he responds very often. In one of the most recent posts, he's responding there. He doesn't confess that he is Angel Moo, but I had hundreds of exchanges with him at one of his videos with that synonym. So I'm pretty sure that it's him. And I linked your video there to him so he can watch and be directed to it if you guys have not done it yet. So he can eventually critique what we are saying here.
Well, everything we've been doing in this series and all of our critiques and rebuttals to these guys, you know, Team Dodgeball, for example, you know, we get no answers. We get no serious critique. They hate the fact that we're here on YouTube, you know, and just kind of destroying their arguments. Matt, I know you were going to say something there, brother.
No, I was just laughing that he's going to do that.
And share these around. I seen in Vice Rhino's comment section from last week, there must have been over a dozen comments of people sharing our video saying, you know, you've been debunked, address this video. He's not going to, because he knows the second he puts a rebuttal video, we're going to be right on top of that. Plus, we'll debate him. You know, I know Neff would love to. I would. So, anyways, maybe Matt, it's up to you, or unless Neffy had something to say, Jason, but I know maybe we should get
to that. We probably need to make this thing flow a little faster.
Yeah.
I will soon leave the stream, SFT, but I would just like to link to my page here about Noah's Flood, because I think that it has been found, the Noah's Ark has been found on Mount Ararat. And it's amazing evidence. So you guys can actually have a look on what I have collected in regards of information in regards of this. It is the site that has been found in 2010 by the Navy team, by the Chinese team, which has been highly disputed. They have claimed that it was a hoax. And Philip Williams has visited the place in 2014, and there is a video. And he's my Facebook friend, and I had a chat with him also on my channel. And I think it's very powerful evidence that the Ark has been found on Mount Ararat. And this year or next year, I'm not sure yet, they will make an archaeological expedition there to collect all the relevant information. And then they will, as archaeologists and professionals, provide the evidence of the age of the wood and so forth. And that will solidify the case, and so they will not be able just to say, oh, it's a hoax, it's a film set and so forth. We will have soon very hard evidence that that site is Noah's Flood, and there is really huge wooden bulks up there, and also wooden walls with pitch. They have found pottery and so forth. So it's very, very strong evidence, and I have collected almost everything which I have found on the web. It's on the link. And have a look. There are great videos of the expedition of Philip Williams as well. So very powerful, very strong evidence that Noah's Flood has happened through that finding of the site. And I think I'm very convinced that it is Noah's Ark.
Well, that's awesome. I just linked it in the comment section as well. And I want to point out too, for Brother Otangelo, he's a warrior, make sure you go subscribe to his channel. It's the God Talk, right, Otangelo?
Yes, correct.
So the God Talk. And if you want to watch a severe abiogenesis beatdown, it was probably about a month ago we had Otangelo on debating Snake was right. And that was a great debate. So make sure you go check that out. Check Brother Otangelo's source there on Noah's Ark, and also go subscribe to his channel. So thanks so much, Otangelo.
Yes, at my channel I have an interview with Philip Williams, which has visited the site on Mount Ararat, and you can watch it there. It's a very nice chat there.
Awesome. Okay,
so I have put here the link, and I'll go sleep. It's late here in Brazil, and thank you for having me at your channel's SFT. See you next time. Bye-bye.
See you on Tangelo.
Take care.
All right, here we go.
The problem isn't just the modern meaning of the word ape, for the definition has changed over time, but also what it means to be human and how modern man relates to the rest of humanity, meaning other now extinct species, which most people don't think about. When I was a kid, it seemed like scientists were the only ones who didn't believe that dinosaurs were giant lizards who lived at the same time as men, because the common concept of the prehistoric world was more inspired by scenes of Raquel Welch than on any actual science. And this imagery was also marketed for children. So I had this entire set of snapped together plastic pieces, including some of the later editions.
Just quickly, could I say something? He says that's all imagery that's modeled on Raquel Welch with, you know, in those old movies, like she's playing an ape woman with dinosaurs sort of thing. Well, what about the March of Progress? And people focused more on the image than they did on the actual... the what they said about it, actually what the evolutionists themselves said about it and the literature. So that image became iconic and became, you know, embedded in people's minds. So, and people, there's a lot of people that are conned into believing evolution is true just from that image. And they don't know anything about evolution or creation science or anything. I'm not saying that you know everybody's like that, but there is a lot of people out there that are just that see that image and just take it for granted. So him saying that is ridiculous. It works both ways.
Yeah, they love their propaganda. That does it.
Thesaurus and the Eocene terror bird, none of which lived at the same time. I remember complaining about that and having to explain that modern men and Neanderthals did live at the same time then, because so many of the adults that I knew thought that Neanderthals were supposed to have been those half-human ape men who the evolutionists believe we allegedly evolved from. I had to explain that no scientist ever suggested that Homo sapiens descended from Homo neanderthalensis, that instead both races were like cousins with the same grandfather. Culturally, intellectually, and anatomically modern humans evidently emerged in Africa within the last 100,000 years or so, and then followed their ancestors in waves of migrations out to the rest of the world. Neanderthals originated in Western Asia at least a quarter of a million years earlier, and then moved into Europe, and over time, their definitive characteristics became more recognizably exaggerated. Their less distinctive proto-Neanderthal ancestors were themselves descended from Homo erectus. This species had many phenotypic subsets known by several different names and were already widespread throughout the tropics of Asia and Africa, where the earliest known member of our species still shared a blend of subtle traits associated with both erectus and Neanderthals. For anyone who still...
Okay, so it looks... So we got a few things to address there. Neanderthals, looks like he had his little... tree with all the different hominins. Whoever wants to start, I definitely have a few things to say, but I'd be happy to go last. Whoever wants to start.
No, you go.
Okay, yeah. Well, I mean, with Neanderthals, for example, right off the bat, there's so many issues with Aron Ra's deep time position, human evolution position. So, questions that I would have for Aron Ra is, how do you answer the fact that everything about the Neanderthal, their form, development, their DNA, you know, I always say that when it comes to ancestry, it's in our genetics, where it's the most direct, most high quality type of science to determine ancestry. And even Aron Ra points out in one of his phylogeny videos that oftentimes there's more variation within the same species than between species. So just looking at bones, morphology, anatomy can oftentimes be deceiving. But when we look at the DNA of the Neanderthal, everything about their DNA suggests that they are in every way, shape, or form human. But the data itself suggests that Neanderthals had a lot of mutations due to inbreeding, due to isolation. They were seriously inbred. The evidence suggests, and I think we would all agree with this, Brother Neff talks about this all the time, they branched away at Babel, maybe before, but then they spread out widely. And they all show serious evidence of inbreeding. And the thing is, most paleo experts, everybody would agree for the most part that they existed in small populations. So therefore, what would be occurring would be rapid genetic drift and fixation of new deleterious alleles, which would explain their unique set of biodiversity when it comes to humans. But everything we see for the most part in the hominin fossil record is simply evidence of what? We talk about it all the time, rapid genetic degeneration, which is why we find skeletal pathology, we find reduced body sizes, reduced brain sizes. And Neanderthals, they just appear to have been just one of the few people groups that suffered from inbreeding and pathology. I do have some slides to go along with that, but if you guys had anything to add on that one.
Yeah, they were just, the evidence simply shows they were human. A number of studies concluded that they their DNA appears to be genetically defunct human DNA. They're disease-ridden group. Lewin in 98, Tinkoff and Shipman in 92, Stringer and Gamble in 93, Holiday in 97, Stringer and Gamble again in 93, Stringer and Mickey in 1996, and another in 92, another in 98, 97, two in 97. So a number of studies studying the DNA of Neanderthal shows that they're strictly human. And after all, the evolutionist themselves admits that humans and Neanderthal intermixed genetically. Well, this proves that we're the same organism. They simply would say, well, you know, we're a bit different, and that's because of evolution. But they were fully human. They buried their dead with flowers. They made flutes out of bone, so they had music and likely art, and they had religion.
And they also you needed to just quickly interject. I won't talk for long. They also could see you had carvings that you needed a microscope to see. Like, so that means their eyes were really spectacularly good.
Good point.
If they could make carvings that were so that fine.
Right. We've gone downhill since then. Our eyeballs are worse than before. But they were just an inbred, disease-ridden tribe of mankind that likely left the Tower of Babel affair early and possibly before the Tower of Babel affair. And if that's so, maybe they were ousted by the people at Babel because they were defunct. And maybe they were genetic, that had deformities, and they were disliked, so they were ousted. And this may explain why they seem to have spread so far and wide on the earth, whereas most tribes of mankind didn't spread as far and wide as the Neanderthal. But yeah, the only evidence we have is that they were fully human and they were disease-ridden people. So they have a heavy bone structure. Their rib cage is a little more barrel-like than a typical human being. They're very robust and muscular. They could have easily been beaten the best wrestler in the world today. You know, a good Neanderthal would just completely own you on the canvas. So, you know, they're just human. That's all the evidence we have.
Well, and like you indicated, I mean, we have evidence.
Just
the
quickly,
Jason, take your time.
Just about that artwork. Sorry, that those small carvings. What I meant to say was, is that those carvings are artwork. They've carved. Right. Isn't that incredible that they can carve intricate artwork that's so small that we need a magnifying glass to see it? That just blows my mind, man. Yeah. Sorry, that's all I want to say. That's it. Sorry.
You take a Neanderthal and put him in a suit and let him walk down New York City. Nobody's going to think he's anything but a human, right? Because, he's just going to be human. Oh, I love this one. Look at the brow ridge and the slant. And this is a modern human. That guy's an action movie actor. I can't remember his name.
Well, he's a Russian boxer. So imagine you found that skull cap isolated, because we do know that they typically find these bones in isolation. They find them in fragments. The fossil record is extremely fragmentary. So oftentimes they do find isolated bones. Therefore, if they found this isolated, this skull cap of this Russian boxer in isolation, they would conclude Neanderthalensis, even though this is a human who's living, breathing, walking around today. This one I find fascinating. This is June 2020. Doesn't get any earlier than that. Humans and Neanderthals, less different than polar and brown bears. Ancient humans, Neanderthals, and Denisovans were genetically closer than polar bears and brown bears. So like the bears, we're able to easily produce healthy, fertile hybrids, according to a study. A question I have for Aron, if he thinks his storyboard fits the data more than the out of Middle East, out of Babel dispersal. Well, the fact is, when Homo sapiens, when they left Africa, they would have had that severe population bottleneck that would have reduced the population to, you know, between 2,000 and 10,000. And this would have happened for generation after generation, probably more than 1,000 years. The reason they invented that was, like we were talking about earlier, humans have low genetic diversity. They were shocked. It was unexpected. They were surprised, as usual. You know, this is typical in the evolutionist story and literature. So they said, okay, you know, there must have been this population bottleneck, and this would have reduced genetic diversity. But the problem with that, we talk about it all the time. I asked that geophysicist guy the question a few times in John Maddox After Show, and they just don't have an answer. The fact is, it wasn't a one or two, you know, generation population bottleneck, because it happened for so long, this small, highly inbred population, these deleterious mutations that are in recessive form, they are now manifested. They lead to rapid accelerated genetic degeneration. So their out of Africa story is not even remotely feasible. But if we give them that, let's consider the fact that, okay, so humans leave Africa, but lo and behold, they are shocked to find other human forms on the earth. So now they've invented two out of Africa's, where prior to Homo sapiens leaving, they had Homo erectus, a subpopulation of erectus, leave Africa. And then the story, there's a number of stories, right? You got the multi-regional hypothesis, the recent out of Africa. They're all, what's funny, when it comes to human evolution, read their own literature. They're all battling each other. They're all contesting each other. So you can get rebuttals right from their own literature, which is funny. So erectus leaves. Evolves independently into your other human forms, Denisovans, Neanderthals. I would say Homo floresiensis. That would explain how Homo floresiensis was even isolated on the island to begin with. You know, we watched a video Matt and I were laughing about the other day, where Gutsick Gibbon tried to say that it was an Australopithecine that evolved into Homo floresiensis, which are the Hobbits. Therefore, she would have to suggest, and Aron Ra would have to suggest, that some apes, right, which don't have human brain and intellect, nor do they have purposeful navigation skills, they would have to say that they just accidentally rafted, you know, a viable breeding population accidentally made their way to the island of Flores through a cyclone or tsunami or something. So it makes sense that erectus, which is a degenerate form of humans, would have also degenerated even further into like your Hobbits, Naledi, and Luzonensis, because these are all isolated on different islands. And you find the same degenerate features and insular dwarfism. But a little bit of a rabbit trail. Question for Aron Ra. If your story is true and erectus evolved independently into Neanderthals, okay, or Heidelbergensis evolved into Neanderthals, whatever, then Neanderthals were separated from humans in Africa for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, let's say 100,000 years. Then humans make their way out of Africa and they meet up with Denisovans, Neanderthals, but yet they still remained interfertile. They interbred and produced healthy offspring, even though humans supposedly went through this radical genetic reshaping in Africa. And Neanderthals would have been evolving independently out of Africa, but yet they still remain interfertile. I mean, pull out the storyboard there. I mean, how is that possible? You know, maybe they were able to interbreed and produce not fertile offspring, but the fact that we have their genetics, the fact that DNA in every shape, in every way, shape and form, proves that they're human. So, Matt, what are your thoughts on that, brother? I know we were talking about that the other day.
Sorry, I was muted. Yeah, there's so much to cover with the Neanderthal. One of the things real quick that Jason mentioned, I just thought I would show it to everybody real quick because it's very fascinating. And then we'll continue on. Is the what they created. Here's the pendant. What they did is they would loop this, put a rope through here, and they would spin it, and it would look like this deer is running. So they clearly were highly intellectual compared to any chimpanzee or primate that there is. And another thing that gets brought up all the time is the predominant brow ridge. They said this is, you know, the lack of chin. They said, oh, look how weak their chin is and look how big their brow ridge is. These things are something.
Did you mention, Matt, just quickly, did you mention, because I felt my thing fell out of my ear, that was the first movies?
No, not yeah. I was just saying that it was a moving picture. Basically, that this is
It. Yeah, that's literally the first movies. That someone carving that and twirling it around, so people sitting down and watching it and going, "Wow!" You know what I mean? Same as people going to a movie cinema today. So it was the first movies.
I know. Back in the Ice Age, pretty incredible, huh? That they had time to do this in that harsh environment where they're messed up and isolated in freezing conditions.
Yeah.
But the other thing, too, I guess I can get on in a little bit, is they always say that the Neanderthal had a big, large brow ridges, and that's what separated them from other human beings. Well, if you actually look at children, they actually didn't have them. These are Neanderthal children and teenagers, and you can look them up. They found more of them than they have adults, and you'll never find a brow ridge. So anyway, we'll move on because the video is longer. I just thought I'd show that to everybody real quick. And I don't know why I closed that. Here we go.
For anyone who still doesn't understand how two sibling species could arise from a common ancestor, but neither would have met the other, it works like this. There may be several different family lines cohabitating one area at one time. Over many generations, some of these will eventually diminish or die out, while others proliferate more abundantly, so that eventually all the modern denizens of that place can only trace their genealogy back a few generations before they find that they all converge on the same ancestry the rest of the way back. The same applies to the macroevolutionary scale as well. This is why the further back you trace any two visibly related lineages, the more their recessed ancestors will resemble each other, because at one time they were the same thing.
That's the problem. The taxonomic boundary paradox that they have, and also the fact that the CO1 gene mutation done by the Rockefeller University discovered the low genetic diversity in all life, completely countering that very argument that he just made. So... good luck on that, Aron.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if he's going to invoke that, oh, you just keep going back in time, and then you're going to see that, oh, well, of course there's going to be a mitochondrial somewhere. Okay, well, answer me this then. Riddle me this. How come she lands around a date that is our model? How come there's no bottleneck, apparently, around 6,000, 6,500 years ago in your model? How come there the odds of this one female, even though there's multiple people living in the world, all just happened to die off, or that they only gave birth to males, or whatever the scenario may be. I would love to hear that rescuing device, because you never actually get a very good one.
Evolutionists rely on visual similarity a lot too. That because two creatures have a lot of visual similarity, and it goes even farther than homologous structures, comparative anatomy. They look at a creature, and if it looks similar in structure in some way, in a lot of ways, to another type of creature, that's obviously because they're closely related. See, it's what's going on in the head of the evolutionist. It doesn't have to, it's not directly evidence of something. It's a story. The evolutionist looks at everything and sees evolution in it, right? So they naturally see any visual similarity or structural similarity as evidence of common ancestry. It's all a big storyboard in their mind.
Oh, yeah. Imagine if today there were no primates alive. Imagine they all went extinct. And remember, only the most recent chimpanzee fossil they've ever found is only in 2015. And it was like a tooth. Like, it's very, very rare they ever find anything at all for a primate. So let's just say that primates were dead and they didn't exist. They would say our closest ancestor would probably be something like a anteater. You know, they would say that's our ancestor because that's what's alive today and that's what we most look like. So there, you know what I mean? There's always something that we're going to be closer to. It doesn't mean that we're related to it. It means that they can find something that we are closer related to. That's it. We look similar to something. That doesn't mean that we're related to it. Simple logic.
Well, I want to point out a fact that he's lying too, because the question is, why is our mitochondrial DNA ancestor so unique? She didn't have to be so unique. We have incredibly low variation in mitochondrial DNA and Y chromosome. And we know that the Y chromosome does some pretty crazy things. It mutates a lot faster, for example. Therefore, the fact that in both our uniparentally inherited DNA compartments, Y chromosome, mitochondrial DNA, they're so similar worldwide. You got no highly ancient or divergent or highly mutated Y chromosomes on the planet. So this speaks of, once again, the youthfulness of the genome, that we came from two common ancestors, a Y chromosome ancestor, mitochondrial DNA ancestor in the not so distant past. But here's the thing. What Aron Ra is saying is erroneous, because there was every possible reason for us to believe, because they never predicted this. Remember, it's always retrofitting. But if evolution, deep time evolution, is true, then we could have discovered that the mitochondrial DNA was, that there, it wasn't so unique. It wasn't just one line, that it might have even been shared with chimpanzees, for example. But the fact that it's just so unique and that every human being's mitochondrial DNA is incredibly similar speaks of the biblical Eve. So, yeah, I don't know, any thoughts, guys?
No, let's keep going.
Keep good going, point. Brother.
The same pattern is reflected in the aging process. This is why the young of two closely related species look more alike than the adults do. Remember also that you can't look back on your own life and determine the hour when you had no more childish traits, but were a fully mature adult. For the same reason, even if you could view all your consecutive ancestors over a million generations, it would still be impossible to positively identify any one individual as the first human. All you would find throughout that time would be communities where individuals show only subtle variations from each other. You would not be able to recognize the year when those once unique traits came to dominate the whole tribe, nor could you ever find one generation in which no one could still interbreed with anyone from the generation before. You could find a collective of chemically interbred.
Yeah, good point to stop. Let me mention something here. Notice he's telling you what would be true if evolution were true, what we would expect, but they don't have the fossils that show anything he's talking about. He's talking about evolution had been true, you would see countless incremental changes and the structural design of the skulls and the bones of living things. And he shows you a video where he's using software to morph one skull into another skull and saying, see, he wants you to see the storyboard in his head. He wants you to believe the storyboard. But guess what? They don't have any fossil evidence that supports any of that illustration on the screen. So that's very disingenuous.
If he goes back in time, when we go back in time, we know that everything was bigger, like Gigantopithecus and all the apes and monkeys would have been bigger as well. Everything was bigger. We know turtles, and they look pretty much similar to almost exactly the same as what the animals look today. They were just bigger. So if you've got like the chimps, this is another variation on what I was saying before. If you've got like chimps or orangutans when they're infants, that their skulls look very human, and chimps when they're infants, their skulls look very human, then if those things were more bigger back then, were more giant back then, you know what I mean? A lot of these things that they're looking at could be just the same species like you have with Homo erectus, and a lot of people think that it's just Homo sapien. And when you look at all the skulls that they've got and skull caps and all the things together, I mean, it just... It's there's so much little variations within it that it could be Neanderthal, could be Homo sapien, could be, you know what I mean? It's just that they're mixing in, you know. Anyway, sorry, I just went off on a tangent.
Well, no, it's a good point, because everything that they anytime they find new discoveries, it's 2020, okay, and there's no less clarity. I mean, there's a paper here, recent discoveries. Hominins have raised the possibility that early hominins were as specious as later hominins. Point is, it's all a mess. They speak, the own paleo experts themselves speak how the human fossil record's a mess. It's a bush. There's no clear progression. Now we know that the Australopithecines coexisted with the Homo genus. There's no clear transition, No clear pattern. It's just, it's a big mess. You know, there's...
Go ahead. How big would a Gigantopithecus newborn be, and how big would its fetus be, and if that skull got fossilized and then some person evolutionist archaeologist digs it up years later, what are they going to go? Oh, proof of ape to human evolution. Oh! You know what I mean? Like, no, it's not.
Well, even like Neff was saying too, they're oftentimes looking at homology, similarities, nested patterns. Even when you look at their trees, whether you're looking at like a phylogeny or a phylogenetic tree, for example, even what you see, so you've got like the apes and humans here, then you've got the old world monkeys, new world monkeys, all the way down to the lemurs here, human, chimp, mouse, lizard, salamander, fish. This is just what's expected in a common design model. So of course, look at their tree here, right? A lot of drawings, a lot of imagination. And it's funny because Nicholas pointed out in the chat, when is Aron Ra going to get to his evidence? Because it's all storyboard, it's all assertions. But we would expect humans, as you can see here, are going to share more in terms of morphology, anatomy, physiology, and genetics with the chimpanzee here, right, which is right next to the human on the branching tree, then the mouse, or then the fish. You know, this is exactly what's expected. That's why we focus on the differentiating lines of evidence. Even within the apes and the monkeys, yeah, of course, we're going to share more with, like, your gorilla, your bonobo, and your chimpanzee than we would with New World monkeys or with lemurs. You could just stand back and see this. That's why the questions that Aron Ra needs to answer are the ones that pertain to your orphan genes, your DNA function, everything we've talked about with the waiting time problem and your proteins and Y chromosome dissimilarity. You know, these are the things they never want to talk about. These are the things that they want to pretend don't exist. So it's just funny. You know, there hasn't even been any evidence presented yet.
Contemporaries whose genetics had become so unique as to be incompatible with some of those who were 1,000 generations distant. Because life is not as static as folks imagine. Living designs are a fluid dynamic. When a population is divided in complete genetic isolation, unique distinctions will arise in each group and the two will grow increasingly apart. The longer this goes on, the less likely it will be to bridge the widening gap and produce viable offspring. Chemical fertility isn't always the determining factor here either. There are instances where two species can interbreed but prefer not to and usually won't under normal circumstances. That may be the case here. Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalensis are very closely related, yet there was little intermingling, only about 10%. People living today show no more than 4% Neanderthal DNA, if at all, and the Neanderthal...
Matt, just pause it for 1 second because he's talking about interbreeding. I'll be 2 seconds. This is why I asked him the question that according to their model, because I like taking their model and pointing out the problems and showing that they have no answers. According to their model, Neanderthals split away from the main human population about, I said about 400,000 or 100,000 years ago. It looks like it's more like 400,000 years ago. They were not part of this African near extinction event. Then humans reunited with Neanderthalensis, which they say are a subspecies or sister species. And although Homo sapiens went through this radical genetic reshaping in Africa, how could they still remain interfertile with Neanderthal? Makes sense for our model. The Earth is 6,000 years. Our genomes are only 6,000 years. They wouldn't have been separated for all that long. Makes sense that they remain interfertile. But according to their model, separated by 400,000 years. Yeah, I'd love an answer to that question.
Well, isn't there goats that were separated from each other by a mountain range, and the goats on one side of the mountain range, you clearly see they were both two different species of goat. I mean, but they couldn't interbreed with each other or something.
Right. Yeah, well, what's the structural design difference between the two? You won't find any. No anatomical difference occurs. So they're still the same organism, just showing variety, which is explained by creation, and no anatomical difference arises. There's just no evidence that mutations create anatomical designs. The anatomy doesn't change because of random mutation. That's just not something that we have evidence for.
I do like the acting in the show, though.
So at the very least, Neanderthals may be our best example of another breed of human. While we may argue over whether Neanderthals had yet met all the criteria required to qualify as another species, there is no doubt.
Just proved they were humans.
Wait, I saw that guy at the bus stop.
Hey, Neff, that was me. I'm very self-conscious over my Neanderthal-like features. See how much propaganda it is with their reconstructions, artistic license and renditions, you know, these movies back in the day, all these ape men, you know, But we just showed, we just spent, what, 30 minutes there going over plenty of sources, images, showing that Neanderthals really are just a human variant. And we'd love
and that gal right there, she's thinking, are you going to hand me that burrito or not?
I've been waiting all day.
Yeah. How long does it take you guys to make a burrito?
That's funny.
Homo floresiensis was unambiguously a different species, even if they could interbreed with us, which they probably could, yet almost certainly didn't. While all hobbits found so far are less than 80,000 years old, their morphology implies that the race must be much older, diverging from our line at least 1.5 million years ago. Because every one of them found so far shares the same primitive and definitive characteristics, many of which are not found in any of us or Neanderthals either. If Homo erectus was...
Recognize that?
Uh-oh.
Yep. So, therefore, the hobbits that got isolated on an island had a different form of reductive evolution because of probably caloric intake, so they had different morphological features. Therefore, it's more primitive than Neanderthal. Like that? See how they just come to their own conclusions based on whatever they want?
And there's that Russian actor.
Yeah, there he is. How they got the old.
Well, it's funny because they're so desperate to claim that Homo floresiensis wasn't a degenerate form of human ultimately, or a degenerate form of erectus. And we've pointed out extensively in videos that island dwarfism, insular dwarfism, like you said, reductive evolution too, based on caloric intake. And you can see on these islands do crazy things. You know, you can get giganticism. You can also get dwarfing, like you see with the hobbits. But how come? Is it all just coincidence that whenever we see these island so-called hominins, right? The Homo luzonensis, Homo naledi, and Homo floresiensis, which is the hobbits. Why do they all, for the most part, you know, there's some dissimilarities, but for the most part, they suffer from the same pathology, the same degenerate features and diseases as each other. But this is exactly what would be expected on islands. You become isolated, you become highly inbred, reductive evolution is at play. And then they point to these australopith-like features, you know, because they're primitive looking when, you know, they're easily explained through the island dwarfism, the pathology, the degeneration of the genome as well. So they don't really have much else other than, and I think Aron even said that if we had the genetics, they would probably have been interfertile. Yeah, this is exactly probably what we'd expect too with erectus, all your Homo species. So go ahead, guys.
How about the, he always says primitive features. How come their brains are always much larger? You notice that? That's exactly what Darwin did not expect. When he saw Neanderthal and saw that the brain was larger, he actually never talked about them ever again. He mentioned them one time in his thing, and he didn't like that at all because that's the opposite of what evolution was expecting.
I got nothing to say. I'm still laughing at Neff's burrito thing.
Hey, look at the muscularity of this model, the back of its neck. Pure speculation. Nothing about the skull indicates right. That kind of muscularity would be there. That's strictly from the imagination of the evolutionists. They put it there because, well, it needs to be there in my mind. So he looks more gorilla-like, you know.
Right. Exactly.
Artistic license. Yeah. Absolutely. It's just like with Artie, you're going to see at the end here, we put a bit of another Christopher Root presentation. He goes over all the different hominins that they've discovered, all the different Australopithecus-like variants and species. And you're going to see that the ones that they desperately hold on to as your best transitions, they're the ones that are highly fragmentary. They're the ones that are highly questionable, less than 20% complete. This is where they can do all the imagination that they want, right? Evolutionists hope, dream, and imagine that we've descended from an ape-like creature. So it's amazing what they can conjure up based on some fossil fragments.
Yeah, what a wonderful hope it is, too. I mean, wow, hope that you're an ape. So everything, no matter what you do, whether it's good or bad, in the end, when the universe just dies out and becomes cold, dead, and dark, everything that everybody did will just all be for nothing. Fabulous.
Right. Because he was talking about the hobbits, their smaller brain sizes, we've touched on this extensively. It all follows through with reductive evolution. But can you touch on that a bit?
The brain is one of the most highly utilized energy sources of the whole body. It requires more ATP than pretty much anything. It requires lots of glucose to fuel it. And the body's very selective on what it's going to use as far as energy goes. So when, let's say that you were trapped on an island, we were on a plane and we crashed. We get to that island, we walk around it, and we realize, oh man, there's a few coconut trees. We find some guava and neither of us can fish. We're out of luck. You know, if there's a couple women there and they're pregnant and they have offspring and they grow up on that island and they're bound to that caloric reduction that's on that island, well, of course, they're not going to grow very tall, right? Because they can't. So generation after generation of highly caloric deprivation is going to lead to a smaller brain because there's not enough glucose to supply it. There is going to be not very many calories, so they're not going to grow big. I mean, what would be the purpose of, you know, growing 6'2", 250 pounds, if you don't even have the calories to support that body type? It would be smarter to be actually reductive and reduce your body size. It wouldn't be detrimental because evolution doesn't think like that. It can't go, oh, we need to, you know, we're right on this island, we need to think about 15 generations from now. No, it needs to keep you alive right now. So the very next generation would already be smaller. So it wouldn't take long to get
there. It happens quickly.
That's right. Evolutionists can't believe that's a bad thing either. That's just evolution. That's all that is.
Well, I want to point out, I want to put this to bed. You know, when it comes to these evolutionists like Aron Ra and Gutsick Gibbon and these ones that love to point to these fossils and try and say that they're pre-humans, every feature that they point to as so-called primitive or pre-human, you can look at, and we talked about this in detail in a stream not too long ago, Matt, but the finger curvature, all your superficial differences, even when they look to the, what they'll look to is the flaring of the ilium of the pelvis. All of these things are actually better explained through inbreeding, through habitual tool use. When it comes to floresiensis, like the curvature in their fingers can be caused by mechanical stress from habitual behavior. And what's funny is when they are already suffering, okay, from island dwarfism, reductive evolution, they will oftentimes be suffering from vitamin D deficiencies. Well, now their bones are weaker, okay, already right off the bat. So now, because we find tools on Flores, these features are not Australopith-like. They're not primitive. They're not evidence for human evolution. They're just evidence for degeneration, island dwarfism.
And the fossil evidence shows that Habilis is actually not homo anyway. It's an example of what it fits neatly into afarensis. I'm going to share some information with you when we get around to it that shows that recent information has shown that the creature fits neatly into the quote-unquote the Australopithecines, not in the homo lineage, as they call it, right. Anyway. So it's not human anyway. The evidence shows that Homo habilis is not human. It's not part of the rectus either. It's not human. That's all.
We'll come back to that.
I would argue that. Oh, go ahead, Matt. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, I'm not sure where in the video that comes up again, but if we don't see it in the next, 10 minutes in this video, then you go over it then.
Yeah, let's do, because yeah, I would even argue that, well, for one, Neff's absolutely 100% right. But I would also argue that most of your bones being attributed to some apes or Australopithecus-like species, and then the ones that they do point to that look more human-like, you know, the select few, I would just say that's because they really are human. This is exactly what happens when you have bone beds that are a mixture of many, many different species, not just apes and humans, and they're trying to, you know, put them together. And because when you look at Habilis and look at the data, virtually all of the bones attributed to Habilis were found as isolated bones or bone fragments. None of them were found physically connected to other bones. So when it comes to Habilis, what you're looking at for the most part is Australopithecus-like bones, with a few exceptions that are just homo bones that have been mixed in. And you're going to see Roop talk about that. So that was a good point, Neff.
Yeah.
Actually, maybe if you want to keep going, Matt, then we can get a little bit more into detail in Habilis and the rest of them once this Keep it going. Keep it going.
Sure.
Our grandfather and Neanderthals are our first cousins. Then hobbits are our second or even third cousins because they still have traits in their wrists and ankle bones, which were already lost in erectus and all subsequent descendants. Hobbits, then, could not have descended from erectus. They must have diverged prior to them, perhaps from Homo habilis, one of the earliest humans and the last one still having skeletal features which are otherwise found only in australopiths and non-human apes like chimpanzees.
Remember, every single so-called primitive feature that they can point to and imagine is pre-human can easily be explained through pathology, disease, habitual tool use, whatever, you name it. And they hate that fact. They hate that. A lot of them won't admit it, but guess what? You'll find this all in their literature.
Or that the animal evidence is that it's strictly an ape anyway.
Boom, exactly right.
Extinct ape species.
Sapiens or Homo erectus, but they are still generally considered human, although they were as distantly related as it is possible for another human to be. They had the smallest proportion of brain size of any human species, but the shapes of the face and the skull were definitely human, and they evidently used fire and made stone tools, which are uniquely associated with them, being unlike those made by any other hominin. Of course, the hobbit's Indonesian location implies that waves of hominin migration out of Africa must have begun earlier than previously predicted. Knowing this, it is not surprising that primitive human skulls, estimated to be 1.8
million... Not previously predicted, as always.
Exactly.
Neither is it surprising that these skulls were morphologically intermediate between Homo habilis and later erectus. These were labeled H. georgicus, or said to be H. ergaster, or something similar. The various phenotypes named in human evolution are often difficult to distinguish. Some paleoanthropologists consider a few of these names to be significant only in cataloging the varieties and migration of early men. In this view, everything from Pithecanthropus through Homo antecessor may just be subtle varieties in a continuous chronological sequence of the same interconnected species, and the transition from them to us is blurred by the abundance of intermediate fossils throughout that series.
Oh dear, did he really say that? Abundance of fossils that shows what they have is a gigantic imaginary garbage bag filled with bits of bones and broken bones from different extinct species of apes that they line up in their imagination because they believe evolution and then classify them with a different species name and declare it to be one of many. When the truth is, you could fit probably most of those bones, fit most of those fossils. You don't know what bone goes to what animal. They find these bones, these examples, spread out over numerous yards, even a quarter of a square mile of area or more sometimes. And they say, oh, well, that must go with that one way over there. Yeah, and then they put them together and create an animal out of them.
Right.
And, you know, what was that example, SFT? The recent afarensis Lucy fossil, they discovered, what was it, a baboon bone.
A baboon bone.
A baboon bone. 40 years. 40 years. That's a baboon bone.
And guess what? You know? And guess what? And they were still able to fit it there as if like, hey, look, this is clearly of the same species. Because once again, you've got your critics, you know, another critic who put out a video recently that said, you know, well, you can find a piece of bone here. Remember, Matt, actually, we were listening to it today, Matt, give your thoughts. We can find a piece of a scapula here and piece of a scapula, you know, miles down somewhere else. But then we can fit them together, you know, just like apparently this happened with Lucy, but let alone, you know, baboon bone, you know, when you have similar skeletal features and structures anyways, it's like Legos or puzzles, like, you know, you'll be able to forfeit whatever you want.
I like the joke that Hovind makes about the situation. Who gave that bomb to that chimpanzee that blew him into bits anyway, you know, that spread him out so far, you know?
Matt, what are your thoughts? You were listening to that too. And Matt, what are your thoughts? Because, okay, so Matt, we're like we asked Gutsick Gibbon, and we're going to ask Aron, if they want to maintain that, you know, Floresiensis, the hobbits got to Flores, because if it's erectus, right, like some paleo experts agree, it makes sense because erectus is human. They had the brain power and the intelligence to sail purposeful navigation to the island of Flores. which makes sense. We see the stone tool use. We see many indications that they were human. Even Aron Ra said that they probably would have been able to interbred. But this is too close for comfort because this fits our model, okay? So now a lot of them are saying that, no, and it was an Australopith-like ancestor that would have evolved into the Hobbits, which means they're saying that an Australopithecine, which does not have the brain power to navigate the open seas, they're now saying that these brain dead apes accidentally rafted to Flores, a viable breeding population accidentally got there. Matt, what are your thoughts on those 2 points? I know you also heard this.
Yeah, unfortunately, it doesn't make any sense logically, because let's say that the current did take them there arbitrarily and they just landed on this thing. Well, now they've just landed on an island where it's even worse for them, right? So they've landed in a place where they've literally admitted, oh, they are going through reductive evolution, right? They don't have they have a lot of abnormalities and they have a lot of problems from interbreeding. So now you're going to tell me that they're going through this interbreeding, but they're evolving better than their ancestors were, and they're learning these new skills and trades, right?
Yeah. So, oh, yeah. That's a great point.
That's exactly the opposite of what would actually occur if they were stuck on an inbreeding island and things were shifting from heterozygosity to homozygosity and they were getting more similarly related. You would get more genetic diseases and more mutations. So there's that. And then another one is, think about what the mainland was actually like. We believe that it was, remember, right after the flood, things were ice. And this was when Neanderthal and Denisovan were up in these areas, and it was bad. So therefore, they knew to try to sail to an island to get away from these bad conditions and get to more of a tropical area. That's why Africa did so good. That's why people that did migrate there stayed there. Because it was more they flourished there more because it's more near the equator. So that's what we see with these people. They tried to leave, and you know they're stuck on the mainland, and they're eating mammoth, and they're like, we got to get out of here. It's absolutely freezing. We have small tribes, and then we probably are warring with one another over the scarce food that there already is. I say we pack up, grab a couple animals, we throw them on a boat, we go and we travel out to some islands. We got to get out of here. Anything is better than where we're at. What happened? They got stuck on an island. Boom. That's the history. That's what we see.
And it led to rapid and accelerated genetic degeneration. That's such a good point you brought up. I'd love to see somebody like Erika, who's just desperate to the point where they got to say some apes accidentally made their way to Flora. So that means the Australopithecine would have evolved on the island into Homo floresiensis and gain those abilities for tool use and human-like qualities. And according to Aron Ra, they were able to probably breed if they wanted to remain interfertile, when in fact what there'd be is devolution, degeneration, island dwarfism. That's such a great point. And then what's funny is her other argument, which was kind of reiterated here from Dessel. We talked about this. We had a good laugh because she tried to say, well, you know, there's the, and I'm sure Aron Ra would use the same argument, so we should put it to bed. Like iguanas and local marine species that make their way to islands, for example, and the elephants, because we know that there's the dwarfed elephants on Flores as well. So, you know, they're claiming that, well, if they're able to make their way to these islands and become isolated and live there, then why not some Australopith, right? What's your answer to that, Matt?
Well, the first part I wanted to answer real quick is, how can they say that these people died out while at the same time saying that they're progressively going up in evolution? And
right? Two contradictory things.
Right. Okay. So let's see what happens today when people are actually going to be going off to islands. What do they usually bring with them? Like the Polynesians, when they go to Hawaii, they bring with them fruits, they bring with them seeds, they bring with them anything that they can travel to eat. Right. So what happens when you're going to be traveling? Well, they also took goats. Well, goats actually ended up ruining one of the islands of Hawaii. To the south of the island of Kauai, there's an island that's there. It's owned by the government now, and nobody else can live there except for local Hawaiians. But there's not a single tree on the island because goats eat them before they can actually grow into a tree. They've completely decimated the entire island. So goats are very, very detrimental. But that was a staple animal that a lot of people used to travel with because it was easy. They can have, they can breed the goats. They can get milk from them. And when they were getting older, after they reproduced, they would eat them for the meat. Same thing would have happened with these elephants. Elephants don't jump in water and catch currents and land on islands. That's never been seen. But yet in their imagination, it's true. It's real. We like to stick to reality. So what would happen? What do they do in India? Well, they took the elephants and they migrate with them. They travel with them. That's what they do. So we have no problem in our model saying that these Neanderthals or whoever it was that took these animals with them, these small babies, and took them to an island with them because it was their food source. It did the exact same thing that goats would have been. They would have waited for them to mature, bred, and then ate the elders like they do with pigs, anything they can. Well, back then in the Ice Age, they're not running around eating pork. They're not eating goats. They had mammoth. So they took one of these creatures, they brought them on the island, and that's what was there. Why are there lizards there? For the same reason lizards are on every island. They're the first to swim to an island. The first thing that shows up are spiders, because spiders can actually weave a web and catch their web and carry air current and almost fly to an island, basically. Then after that, it gets the insects, and then you get some rodents and lizards. So it's not speculation. That's what happens after volcanoes go up and they destroy and decimate an entire island where there's no life left. Boom, after a couple decades, everything is back. Everything is back just the way it was, because that's what happens. They can swim out to islands. It's not a mystery. That pretty much does it, I think. I mean,
well, I got to say, slam dunk points, because our critics, Team Dodgeball, say that they're working on, you know, a big rebuttal video where they're just going to dodge, duck, dip, dive, and dodge 99.9% of our points. And what's funny is, supposedly, you know, our points on Homo floresiensis, the hobbits being a degenerate form of human, would be demolished. And yet we pointed out that the problem of how did the pre-humans or the, you know, arrive on the island of Flores, it was never accessible through a land bridge, according to their model, even during the Ice Age when the sea levels were lower. So we predicted, okay, well, you know, Gutsick Gibbon, Aron Ra, same thing, if he does a rebuttal video, so we might as well leave no stone unturned, would have to say that it either happened by accident, right, through natural rafts of vegetation, or a tsunami, something far-fetched and ridiculous, right? Maybe this could happen to one individual, but it's extremely unlikely and implausible to have occurred to a viable breeding population. Here's the thing. Here's the most parsimonious explanation. Hobbits obviously sailed to the island, which makes sense because they are a variant form of erroneous, like many paleo experts would agree. This suggests they were human because why? Purposeful navigation would be the observation here. Building boats and then navigating the open seas is clear indication that erroneous and ultimately hobbits are human, but it's too close for comfort. So they have to come up with this ridiculous excuse. And do you see how easily it was demolished and refuted? But they will still hold on to it because it's the storyboard. You know, it's the rescue device. Go ahead, whoever wanted to talk next.
What do you think, Jason?
No, I forgot. not wasn't that important anyway.
Yeah, let's keep it going. It's good points, SF.
This is going to be the video for everybody to watch right now. This isn't just Aron Ra anymore. So for the next 10 minutes, it's going to be, I think 10 minutes anyway, maybe less. But this is going to be a video for everyone to enjoy. Ready?
Yeah. Third major thing that we found was that we're seeing a clear separation between the ape type, which they call Australopithecus, and the human type, Homo. And this, as you would expect, this is a very natural biblical prediction, right? We would expect if God created Adam and Eve, and on the same day he created apes and a diversity of apes, perhaps, we would expect that they would be quite separate and distinct because one did not evolve gradually into the other. And so here we have an expert in the field saying, no doubt about it, Australopithecines are like apes, and the Homo group are like humans. And I want to qualify that because I do not believe, based on the research we've done, that Australopithecus is a pure hypodyne or a pure genera. What I mean by that is I believe there are a number of human bones, anatomically modern human bones, that have been misclassified as Australopithecus. But in general, most of the bones, you can say, are probably going to be ape. But we'll talk about some evidence that there's been some mixing. Okay, but that's an interesting point she's making. There are two distinct types, the ape type and the human type. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not variation, right? We know that there are lots of variation in modern human skeletons, people living today. And so you can imagine that we also expect that in the fossil record. Nevertheless, even accounting for the variation, we still see that you can separate them out. And you can do that whenever you find the specimens well-preserved. So if you find a complete
limb bone that has the diagnostic aspects preserved, such as the distal end or the proximal end, you can actually tell, yes, this is an ape or this is a human. However, when you have very fragmentary remains that are not clearly associated with more bones, then obviously that gets more complicated. But the point is that whenever you find intact, well-preserved specimens, it's very easy to separate them out, human or ape. And so let me just give you an example. Turkanaboy. Turkanaboy was attributed to the species Homo erectus. And by the way, Homo erectus is experts in the field who are called lumpers would say they should be just considered Homo sapiens. Okay, they say the differences have been exaggerated. So think about Turkanaboy is attributed to Homo erectus. We find 90% of its skeleton, I'm guesstimating here.
So here we go. Here we go. This is good. We're going to see how fragmentary a lot of these are.
Later on. Neanderthals. We have about 500 different Neanderthal sites. So we've had many specimens of Neanderthals. And we've been able to compile a composite skeleton. So for all practical purposes, we have the complete skeleton of Neanderthals. We know what they look like. And contrary to early claims, Neanderthal appears to be fully human anatomically. And so it's interesting, we have clarity whenever we have the well-preserved specimens. But now considered the fossils that have been proclaimed as missing.
Pause that real quick, Matt. No, it wasn't me. You must have taken this from my other video.
Oh.
So I'm sure, so you're probably gonna hear us talking here then, Matt. That's good though.
That out. Let me see.
If so, that's okay. Actually, you know what? Pause it real quick, even though I probably say the same thing that you took it from. But I just want all the audience to see here, okay? So whenever we see the evolutionists have nothing now, okay, to use for their fancy story. Because when it comes to like Neanderthal, Hobbits, Erectus, Naledi, Australopithecines for the most part, you know, we can easily tell if they're a human form or an ape form. Now their so-called best transitions that they love to harp on. Guess what? The reason why is because habilis, less than 20%, sediba, extremely fragmented. What a joke. Even Lucy itself is 20% complete when you consider everything, not 40. Artie, 45%, extremely crushed and broken, roadkill. This is where they can play their manipulation games. They can pull out their storyboards. They can imagine all day. But no, when it comes to the so-called hominins, where we have the data, where we have the genetics, that's where it's easy to tell. We can see a clear separation of the ape and human types. I just wanted to point that out for the audience.
Nice.
So-called missing links are still proclaimed as missing links.
Well, Matt, brother, can you hear me?
Oftentimes they're fragmentary. I think that's interesting because that's when you can invoke more speculation and artistic license in the reconstructions and in the interpretations. So let's consider Ardi. Ardi is about a skeleton found in Ethiopia. It's 45% complete. But when Tim White discovered these remains in the early 90s, about 1994, he described them as roadkill. They were pulverized. In fact, the skull was, he said it was pancaked and crushed down to 4 centimeters in height, broken into 100 pieces. He joked, it's almost like a rhinoceros had stepped on it and crushed it. And so these bones that they're finding, it took them 17 years to reconstruct the Ardi skeleton. And the reason why it took so long is because they couldn't even reconstruct it physically. The bones were so fragile. They were dispersed over a span of over a mile. And so they had to do it digitally reconstructed. They couldn't be sure they were even the same species, despite their claim that they had found a missing link in the oldest human ancestor. And Lucy, Johansson claims it's 40% complete. Well, actually, if you count the missing bones of the hands and feet as you should, Lucy is actually only 20% complete. And the bones were found eroding out of a hillside in 1974 in a far region of Ethiopia. And he noticed that many of these bones were just scattered and jumbled. He said if it was another rainstorm, they would have washed off the cliff. And he assumed they were all belong to a single species. But we can be skeptical of that because he had to screen about 20 tons of sediment over an area of 50 square meters. And it turns out that they accidentally included a baboon bone in the skeleton. It's been on display for decades until just in 2015, they realized we have a bone that does not belong to this skeleton. And so I wonder, and I am skeptical, I'll reserve my judgments for now until we get a publication, that there might be other bones that do not belong to Lucy's skeleton. And now Setaba, same thing. They found Setaba in a pit with thousands of bones of all kinds of different African fauna, 34% complete for one skeleton and 46% complete for the other. And so there was some confusion as to whether or not all the bones belong. And lo and behold, experts now say, some experts say it's actually a mixture of human and ape bones. Hablis, the same thing. It's less than 20% complete. It's, and I'll show you a picture in a moment. But notice that the missing links are generally consistently very fragmentary, very poorly preserved. Why is it that we don't see the missing links of very complete skeletons? Or if we do, oftentimes they're in mixed bone beds. Okay, so here's a picture of Turkana boy, which is clearly human. And even the Bishop of Kenya says he wants the skeleton back to give it a proper burial instead of putting it in the museum. And so experts are now pretty surprised since 1984 was discovered. They say it looks like Homo erectus is much more human than we ever imagined. And so here's, on the right though, is a missing link, belongs to Homo habilis. But if you notice, look how fragmentary the missing link is. Okay. The next major theme we found is that we're finding that there is an extensive coexistence of the Australopithecus type with man. That's really interesting because, let me just read this quote. So here's from an expert in the field who's saying, humans first evolved in Africa, in East Africa, about 2.5 million years ago, and from an earlier genus of apes called Australopithecus. So this represents the fundamental assumption of the ape-to-man story that we've been taught since the 70s to the present. And it claims that Australopithecines, like Lucy's kind, which lived about 3 to 4 million years ago, gave rise to the earliest members of the genus Homo, such as Homo habilis. And that happened around 2.5 million years ago, the earliest members of the genus Homo arose. And so, but now we are finding a lot of evidence, mounting evidence, that anatomically modern human bones are being found in the deepest layers where we find the earliest Australopithecines. So that calls into question the fundamental assumption of the ape-to-man story that is currently being taught all around even the world. And so has this claim, though, been confirmed by the fossil record? And so, as I just said, we're seeing a reversal of that, of this story. So here is just some evidence. In the 1970s, which is considered the golden decade of paleoanthropology research, that time period in history was instrumental for giving rise to the modern theory. And so at these three major East African sites in Kenya, in Ethiopia, and in Tanzania, they found numerous thousands of butchered bones, a diversity of stone tools, human footprints, human bones, a windbreak shelter, an aldivi, communal centers and living sites. They found extensive evidence of human culture and human behavior, and even humans buried with Australopithecus. And that's interesting. So if Australopithecus gave rise to modern humans, why are they found buried together? So here's famous paleoanthropologist Richard Leakey. He comments on this finding, and he says, I see no reason that bands of Homo would not have killed and eaten robust Australopithecines when they could, just as they killed and ate antelopes and other prey animals. And indeed, they find these sites, and they call them living sites. They're effectively like campsites where they would butcher remains, they would eat them, they would apparently...
Eating the missing link, how about that?
Eating social behavior. And so they're pretty nomadic tribes that are simply hunting and eating these animals.
Crazy.
Richard Leakey, in Nature, in 1971, he says there's no evidence, however, and by the way, his views haven't changed much since then. I've been able to talk to him recently. He says there seems no evidence, however, that the genus Homo at Rudolph, which is East Turkana, had any direct relationship to the Australopithecine population of the same time with which it shared its habitat. The concept of gracile, which means lightly built, Australopithecine being ancestral to Homo and the lower Pleistocene requires careful re-examination. The Lake Turkana material, or East Turkana material, seems to confirm the view developed as a result of work at Aldivi Gorge in Tanzania that Homo and Australopithecus are two quite separate and distinct early Pleistocene hominins. So what is he saying here? He's saying that the Australopithecus did not give rise to the genus Homo, but they are two distinct parallel lineages. They coexisted and they don't have a relationship with each other. He believed that the common ancestor would be much earlier. We still haven't found it. Around 4 to 6 million years ago, we still haven't found that common ancestor. So his view, in a way, is somewhat reminiscent of the biblical perspective where we see Australopithecus and man coexisting, okay? Now, here's the interesting history that I want to share with you. So are we finding these types of evidences, like stone tools, human bones, and so forth, dating even to the time of Lucy's kind, 3 or 4 million years ago, which is prior to the origin of the genus Homo, you can understand why that would be a problem, right? So are we finding examples of that? Well, we are. And they were described by none other than even Donald Johanson himself. In the 1970s, Anna Leakey's, Mary Leakey and Richard Leakey. So they found human limb bones, human jaw bones, human hands, human foot bones, human footprints. And by the way, they didn't just report these as just, you know, the Homo type, because that can be pretty broad according to their definition. They would actually describe them as indistinguishable from modern Homo sapiens, even Homo sapiens. And so this is an interesting bit of history that I'm discussing here. So what happened? And well, in 1976, Donald Johanson and his colleague even reported in the journal Nature that they're finding evidence, and you probably can't read it here, it's small, but he's showing that we find clear evidence for the coexistence of Australopithecus and Homo. Of course, that's not the model that's taught today, is it? Because today they teach that no one gave rise to the other. So what happened? Well, Johanson decided to change, he changed his mind completely. He was influenced by Tim White, who is an expert in the field, who believed that you can't have more than one hominid species living in the same area of East Africa during a time period of 3 to 4 million years ago. It was called the single species hypothesis of it. So he believed all of those bones had to belong to just one type, not Homo naturalis. And so Johanson was eventually convinced of his model. He changed his mind. So let me just reiterate what I'm saying. He says, so this is what I'm writing. So the current model that we're now taught was popularized in the late 70s by Donald Johanson and Tim White, who claimed that all members of the genus Homo descended from Lucy's kind and that the origin of genus Homo arose about 2 to 2.5 million years ago. Therefore, according to this popularized model today that is still taught, no anatomically modern human fossils or stone tools should be found buried together with Lucy's kind 3 to 4 million years ago. Except the problem is, Donald Johanson just described numerous bones as looking just like modern Homo sapiens. So he was stuck. And he said, oops, I was wrong. I made a mistake. And it was just a preliminary assessment. And so he changed the story. And then he said, actually, all of those human bones should now be reclassified as members of my species, Australopithecus afarensis. And Lucy became famous. Johanson became famous. And that popularized the model that we have here, right? Australopithecus giving rise to Homo habilis and Homo erectus and so forth. Okay, so this was an important time in history. But let's go back to that point that I just made. So what about all those human bones though, right? What about all those, the stone tools and things like that, that, you know, things we shouldn't be finding? Well, such findings would falsify the popularized ape-to-man story, as I'm explaining. So here's what's happening in recent years. It turns out Johanson's original assessment was more accurate than we realized.
Is that real quick, Matt? I want to make one point. So what he said there is key. His original assessment was more accurate and fit the data much better than his reassessment. Because remember, this is an evolutionary strategy or tactic where they find evidence that's inconsistent, that even seems to falsify the theory, because we could live with our grandparents. We obviously can coexist with our parents, but we can't coexist with our great, 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 great grandparents. Okay. That's where they go wrong. And oftentimes our critics will point to new assessments, you know, that maybe were done in 2018, 19, that apparently overturns the original assessment. No, a lot of times the original assessment is the more accurate assessment. And I want the audience to understand that too, because the evolutionists, the critics, when they're trying to rescue their theory, they'll use that argument a lot. But a lot of times it's just a psychological game, so.
Exactly. They do the same thing with molecular clocks.
Finding more and more examples of stone tools, sophisticated stone tools. So these are the type of stone tools that no living ape could ever manufacture. And we've done a lot of experiments on that. We're finding butchered bones, more human foot bones, more human footprints, and a partial human skeleton, and they're dating to the time of 3 to 4 million years ago. So these we should consider these rude fossils. They're appearing where they should not appear. So here's a picture of some recent, this is 2016. Pilot experts found more footprints than they told me. Remember, She went through the book. Mary Leakey discovered fossilized footprints in Tanzania in the 1976, 1977, 1978. Around that time period, they found thousands of trackways, and among them were human footprints. And so now they found more of them. And this is interesting because the new footprints I'm showing you here, this is called Site S. So it's a different site. It's equivalent age, the same tuff they date. It's 3.7 million years old, according to the conventional dating methods. And if you look at those footprints, they look anatomically modern, don't they? And so, in fact, they're actually pretty large. And so this individual would have had larger shoe size than me. And they describe him as chewy. It's supposedly the biggest Australopithecus on record. The problem is we've never seen Australopith with perfectly human feet that are clearly associated or anatomically associated with a skeleton that is something that's not human. So what's a more reasonable interpretation? Well, the reason why these footprints look so human is simply because, no, humans did live that long ago. And during the time of Lucy, I mean. And here's another skeleton they found, a partial skeleton. This was found also in the far region of Ethiopia, where the remains of Lucy were found. And this skeleton was nicknamed Katanumu, which means big man. And so here we have a large footprint and a large skeleton. And so, again, this is this. And if you look at these bones enough, when you see the skeleton, you instantly say, that's a human skeleton. And that's how experts in the field are describing big man. They say, this big man skeleton looks like a modern human skeleton. And so they're now trying to redefine how they see Australopithecus. They say Australopithecus looks much more like Homo erectus, which, as I mentioned, has a human skeleton, and lumpers say is Homo sapiens.
Another alleged controversy thrust in my face was the discovery of a relatively complete fossil hominin known as Ardi. My critics jeered that she was supposed to prove that Lucy wasn't the ancestral link we always said she was. But if they would look at my older posts, they would see that I already knew about Ardipithecus back in the mid-1990s, and I was a little surprised to see her show up in the media again. Back then, we're known only from fragments or a single tooth, not the cache we have now. What we have does not remove Australopithecus from the sequence. Ardipithecus only adds yet another link to an already fairly complete chain. While this newly announced collection also claims to be the death knell for the out-of-the-savannah hypothesis, it does not radically alter or deviate in the least from my original interpretation, and it offers evidence against the notion of aquatic apes. In summary, everything I read about the newly discovered details of Ardipithecus ramidus are the same things I had predicted when all we knew about it was fragmentary. I would have been surprised if it had been otherwise, but of course the announcement that evidence continues to compile confirming the consensus won't make sensational newspaper headlines.
Okay, so if you guys want to cover Ardi first, and then Neff, I'm going to remind you that you wanted to talk about Habilis one more time. Am I good? Hello?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, brother.
Yeah, go ahead, man.
Oh, no, I was saying, you guys, if you wanted to talk on that, because this is my ending that I made right here, I'll talk after you guys. Habilis is just, he's all messed up, but Ardi is the most popular one that they talk about right now. Ardi is a very, very popular one. I'm not sure when Aron actually made this video, but a lot's come out since then. Matter of fact, in your book, Human Evolution, you talk about Ardi.
Well, yeah, in that book, actually, I have it right here. You can see it on page, was it 136? I point out clearly that Ardi is highly questionable. It relies on heavy inferences because the bone pieces themselves were all scattered, incomplete, and crumbling. And the fact is the hip actually was extremely fragmented. The hip was actually crushed. And the rebuilding of the hip was done so in a way the proponents of evolution believed would be the best for their human evolution narrative. So there's been, given the condition of the hip, Owen Lovejoy, he's the anatomist who was given the duty to digitally reconstruct Artie's crushed hip, was in the situation to reconstruct it any way he pleased. So there's been heavy inference a lot of imagination, and the interpretations based off of Artie are highly questionable and based on limited data. And that brings me back to my point that when we find full skeletons, for the most part, when we have the genetics, we can clearly tell, hey, this is a human variant. Hey, this is clearly some kind of ape type. It's only where you find the extremely fragmentary evidence. It's when you find these bones in isolation. It's where you find them in bone pits with multiple other species. That's where they want to focus and say, these are the transitions that you can't refute. You know, and you're right, that's the book. When in fact, it's just based on such sketchy evidence. It's almost laughable, to be honest with you. But yeah, go ahead, brother.
Oh, I was just going along with the right out of your book. I was just letting everybody see that section right here, because Artie didn't even have a face, but they reconstructed one for everybody. Notice that.
They used to talk about Ardipithecus sediva. They've kind of gotten silent about that one. Part of the reason, I think, is because it just wasn't accepted widely enough. And they also committed what I would consider fraudulent activity. On the cover of Smithsonian Magazine showed images of the skull of Ardipithecus sediba. And they had the head of the creature rotated at an angle so as to make it look like the front of the animal's face was much flatter than it normally would, to make it look more human so that you could believe that it's an ancestor of man. But when I made a rebuttal video to this animal several years back, and what I did is I rotated the skull of Ardipithecus sediba so that its eyes would be level with the ground. You know, it would be, the eyes would be looking straight ahead at the horizon, which is the way that you orient a skull to determine how sloped the frontal is or not, right? And when you do that, guess what? That muzzle sticks way out like an ape, right? But not on the cover of Smithsonian Magazine. They rotated the thing by about 16 degrees. To make the face look flatter. This is how evolutionists play games with things to make things evolution look believable in your mind. It's very dishonest.
It is. Remember, they used Artie as one of the reasons that bipedalism actually really started to take effect, because they said Artie was the first one to walk in the woods. You know, it's standing in the Havana to see over the high bush, kind of like Lucy, right? She was the first one to like come down out of the tree and stand up a little bit and then go back into the tree to sleep. But Artie was the first one that they said was like, oh yeah. Why? Because they had that crushed hip. They didn't have to have any evidence at all. They could just infer it. And then if it was wrong later, they just erase it. They never mention it. Every time they're falsified, they brush it under the rug and move along like nothing ever happened.
We've all seen the video that the idiot evolutionists put forth themselves, showing Lovejoy modifying reconstruction of the fossil, molded pieces that were made from it, and so that they fit together right. I mean, to look like a human, because the curvature wasn't right. It just wasn't it was curved a little too much. So they took some of the curvature. He takes the curvature out to make the iliac blades of the pelvis look more human-esque. It's utter scientific fraud.
Nonsense, isn't it? Nonsense. Unbelievable that it passes. And then they go, and then they won't let creation research get in through it. That's not real science.
I've got that video available if you guys want to play it a little later on, maybe. It's only about two and a half minutes long of Lovejoy playing games with fossils with a Dremel.
I'd love to. Yeah, let's play that. Actually, if you want to dig it up.
No, it's available. I got it right now, but I mean, we can watch it anytime you want. We can do it later if you like.
Okay. Well, I wanted to point out too, before, if it's only a couple of minutes, heck, let's leave no stone unturned and make it impossible for Aron to respond. And we definitely challenge him, answer the questions, the prompts. So let's, if you want to get that video ready, Neff, I also wanted to point out one quick thing about the Hobbits, because they actually compared Hobbits' brain through, because what they did was something called endocast. They can do endocast scans. And the researchers actually compared hobbits' brain, their shape, to that of chimpanzees, Homo erectus, and a modern woman, and a modern human who suffered from microcephaly. Now, their comparative analysis revealed that hobbit looked most similar to Homo erectus, but only smaller, which actually fits what we're saying, that Homo erectus is what gave rise to the hobbits, and the hobbits being a highly degenerate form. But everything else, like regarding their tool use, everything that they built, paleo experts have called them sophisticated in their tool use and craftsmanship. So I just kind of wanted to put that to bed there as well, because, you know, there's still people trying to fight that they're pre-human. But yeah, let's play this video, and yeah, let's do it.
Make sure. Okay. Tell me if you can hear it or not immediately when it starts, please.
Yeah,
we can hear it.
Lucy turned old predictions upside down. It was thought the missing link would be a smart ape that walked on all fours. Here was the skeleton of a creature that looked like it could walk like us, but with many ape-like features. The ape that stood up, it was a revolutionary idea. We needed Owen Lovejoy's expertise again, because the evidence wasn't quite adding up. The knee looked human, but the shape of her hip didn't. Superficially, her hip resembled a chimpanzee's, which meant that Lucy couldn't possibly have walked like a modern human. But Lovejoy noticed something odd about the way the bones had been fossilized.
When I put the two parts of the pelvis together that we had, this part of the pelvis has pressed so hard and so completely into this one that it caused it to be broken into a series of individual pieces, which were then fused together in later fossilization.
After Lucy died, some of her bones lying in the mud must have been crushed or broken, perhaps by animals browsing at the lakeshore.
This has caused the two bones, in fact, to fit together so well that they're in an anatomically impossible position.
The perfect fit was an illusion that made Lucy's hip bone seem to flare out like a chimp's. But all was not lost. Lovejoy decided he could restore the pelvis to its natural shape. He didn't want to tamper with the original, so he made a copy in plaster. He cut the damaged pieces out and put them back together the way they were before Lucy died. It was a tricky job, but after taking the kink out of the pelvis, it all fit together perfectly, like a three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle. As a result, the angle of the hip looks nothing like a chimp's, but a lot like ours. Anatomically, at least, Lucy could stand like a human. The case for our earliest ancestor walking upright was growing stronger, and Lucy wasn't the only evidence.
Well, there he is. Absolute scientific fraud. The pieces fit together too good because they had not enough curvature to the iliac blades of the pelvis, which is a feature of a bipedal organism, a human being. Humans' iliac blades curve forward, and this is one of the things that makes it possible for us to be bipedal and walk upright. But the fossil of Lucy didn't look that way. Its iliac blade pelvis, iliac blades of its pelvis flare out to the side too much, like a chimpanzee, which means it couldn't have been bipedal. So Lovejoy fixed that by claiming that the pieces were fused together so in an anatomically wrong position to put them back into what they would have to have been for the creature to have been bipedal. He made a model of it, destroyed part of a model, and ground bits away to make them fit a little bit more closely to that of a human's pelvis with more of a curvature to the iliac blade, and then claims, see, that's what it really looked like. I mean, this is absolute scientific fraud. It's laughable. It's dishonest. And if creationists played these kind of games with bones in order to fabricate a fossil evidence of creation, evolutionists would never let you forget it.
I know, right? Yeah, they do it all the time. And then they're like, oh, well, like Aron says, we can't let those creationists talk. All they do is lie. It's like, that's his excuse for timing you out or interrupting you or being rude and condescending or just literally screaming over you. So it's kind of funny that that's his excuse when literally all he's doing is backing up and screaming lies. See, what happens is people get mad at us, but what we're doing is actually helping them. We're showing them that they were lied to, and then they get pathologically unhinged, yet we're the ones trying to go out of our way to help them. It's very ironic, very, very peculiar to me, because I was fascinated to get another viewpoint. These people are mad that they get another viewpoint.
That's right. Great point, Matt. That's an excellent observation. You're so right about that.
Well, they're so indoctrinated that somebody like Aron Ra, especially for his own audience, he doesn't want them to get another viewpoint. He doesn't want them to hear our model, our side. That's why he will never agree to an actual formal structured debate where you get both debaters are evenly timed. You know, Aron Ra can't interrupt you because he'll say, oh, I'm going to stop you the second you say a lie. But that which he is calling a lie is actually just the empirical scientific data that's refuting his position.
Right. Dan did the same thing with me in my discussion. I challenged him to a structured debate. He didn't want that, so he invited me to a live stream. As soon as I started providing evidence that refutes his claims, oh, it's time to silence the opposition.
Right.
That's the game he played. So I just said, well, forget that. If that's all you're going to be, I just left. I didn't say another word. I just disappeared. I jumped out of the and let him play that game. And he sat there with egg on his face like, did Neff leave? It was embarrassing for the guy. You could see embarrassment on his face for the first 2-3 minutes after that.
Yeah, no, we can't let these guys get away with it. They don't want... Here's what's funny is I was on an atheist channel, it must have been a month now, called Gonna Go For It. You watched it, Neff, where these guys... It was a two-on-one. They were talking over me the entire time, okay? I exposed their worldview. I was thinking about leaving, you know, a few different times. But I was like, you know, I'm just going to just expose these guys, whatever. Hour and a half later, I uploaded it to my channel. These guys knew that they got demolished so bad. Even though I was there for the discussion, I uploaded it to my channel. They gave me a copyright strike. I had to take it down. And to this day, it's been a month, I can't upload it. I can't upload a debate / discussion that I had. I gave my own time and energy, expose these guys. But yeah. I mean, how sad is that when they're so embarrassed, they don't even want you to upload it to your channel.
Right. They keep that one silent. Yeah.
I've got one more thing to share with everybody. I just want to, can you see this? Can you guys see this one good?
Don't see it yet.
No. Okay. I messed up then.
Where it says, I did modern human skull.
Yes. Yeah. There we go.
Now I see it. Yeah.
Okay. This is what we see today. This is the foramen magnum, which just means big hole. This is in the base of the spine, comes into the skull. Now, right here is the very middle. And the reason it's in the middle is because of bipedalism, right? This is the center balance. This is the center of gravity, and it's the easiest to balance our skull on this. In primates, it's usually found in the back because they walk on all fours. And the orbital tilt makes it so that they should be able to see forward when they walk. We need to look a little bit down. So that's the difference. All right. Now, here is where it gets interesting. Second. This is also a human. Look at that. Very back of the skull. Now you can see why. Look at that. Elongated skull. You see what happened? In Peru, they bound their skull. And when you bind the skull and you allow it to grow, the weight shifts and the burden of the skull has now shifted into the back. So what happens is in the lifetime of a human being, it shifts. It's not over decades. It's not over years. It's an epigenetic regulation that takes effect in the lifetime of the person. Here's another Peruvian skull that's not elongated, and it's where ours is today, right in the middle. but yet this person lived at the exact same time, in the exact same place, in the same part of the world, eating the same foods, talking the same language. Now, why is that? Notice that you have to align the skull, even with these little coasters, in the back so that they lean forward far enough for the human to even see, in a very different position than humans have it today. Because of this weight.
Wrapping the skull, binding the skull with material to elongate it from youth onward. Yes.
Exactly. Now remember, they said this is only found in primates. And as they evolve, this hole evolved and slowly moved forward towards the center. Now we know from epigenetics that this is not true. We can clearly see it in humans, in South America, and many places in the world. Not just there, but you can clearly see it in the back of the skull when they do cranial binding. Here is a modern-day skull. Here's the Peru and skull. Look at, I would love to see the one on this skull. That's incredible. But just have a couple examples. And then I have even, oh, I showed this one twice, my bad. And then I have another couple examples. Here's an infant, cranial bound, lived for about a year and a half. And here's the eyes and the mouth. I highlighted it so you can see. And the skull is bound. Now look at where the spinal cord enters the skull. Already it's shifting to the back for balance, even though this infant is very young. Here's an adult going into the back of the skull, a little impeded because of the hair. Here's a living human being with an elongated skull. As you can see, the neck is very, very different in its positioning, trying to incorporate the new weight of the skull. This is from a video. I don't have any sound because I just wanted the visuals for you guys to see. He is holding a modern human skull that's been cranial bound in a, you know, modern day right here, and then ancient right here. Look at that. In the far back, exactly where it would be in a primate, yet this is a human. And it changed in the very lifetime of that human being. Not over generations, not over thousands of years, and not even millions of years, in one lifetime. And look at this study. Here's something else amazing. This study talks about exostosis. And basically what this is bone that grows on top of other bones. What this study looked at is they found that older people, young kids, are now growing an extra bone on the back of their skull right here. Do you know why? Because they're looking down at their phones so much.
Oh my goodness, are you serious?
Yep, that's the prediction of the studies. They said that this is never seen in young adults, really. They never expected it, and yet it's found right there. And this bone is added for extra weight because it needs to balance the skull for the angle that the spinal column is going into the body, and the kids are looking down so much that the weight is trying to pull it back. So that's a new bone forming in the same generational time as a human being. And guess what? That orbital plane would be adjusted if there was even more weight. But since they're looking down, this is the compensation that's growing because of that. Here's the study for it. So we have multiple examples now of this so-called best evidence for evolution, the foramen magnum being in the middle for humans and slowly over generations and different speciation rates and different things like Sahelanthropus sagensis, for example, where it's a little bit closer than the other ones. Well, look at this. A regular human being, no different from anybody else in the far back because they bound their skull. So did their parents have this? No, unless their parents bound their skull, they didn't. So why would it be there if it's so easily changed? According to evolution, it shouldn't be easily changed. It takes millions and millions of years to slowly adjust to bipedalism. Yet here's a modern day human walking around that adjusted to the back in one lifetime. I just thought you guys would
like. That's pretty incredible.
I got to say, that's fascinating, Matt. I was saying in the chat that this one's new to me and it's brilliant. So let's see your human evolution fanatics address that one. Absolutely brilliant, brother. Good job.
Thanks. I think I did it on the video too. That was it. So Jason, man, if you got anything you want to share, you store up slides and everything, I thought.
I think Jason was saying in the private chat that it might be passing out. So, I mean, looks like we we made it to the end. And as we said in the beginning, when you say more things wrong in one sentence than words there are that are in that sentence, even though I'm tired, if there is a response at some point, I doubt it. And, you know, me and Neff have already stated that all of these guys that we are addressing in this new series, we will also debate the challenges out there, you know, as long as it's a structure, evenly timed debate. That goes for Vice Ryan, that goes for any of these guys. You know, we challenge them to debunk the arguments. But I wanted, and Neff, you can touch on this too. If you want to just give me a couple minutes, I'm going to go through a couple of these slides that I got. Homo habilis.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. You've got Habilis and Sidiba for the most part in Artie. Okay, the highly fragmented, laughable, so-called transitionals that they look to because they got nothing else. But I wanted to point out just how, like, for example, here. So I'm going to link in the description box. So there's an entire series on YouTube. Highly recommended. It goes through all the different hominins, goes through all the different chapters in contested bones. Matt, you and I, they're long. They're extremely kind of dry, but you get a lot of good info from them. So since we're nearing 3 hours, I'm just going to go over a few of the slides that I found in there that I found very interesting. So Habilis, for example, paleo expert Richard Leakey and son of the discoverers of Habilis have noted that Habilis has always been controversial in anthropology. Here's interesting too. Habilis was erected as a taxon with almost no evidence. As one paleo expert put it, it was established on the basis of material so scanty and incomplete. So like I said earlier, we can oftentimes get quotes. We can look at the technical literature from the paleoanthropological community and find that they're all in disagreement. They all contest each other. And so here it says the defining specimen of Habilis is OH7, which consists of stray finger bones making up a partial hand. Okay, this is where it comes down to how fragmented these so-called best, quote-unquote, transitional forms are, which consists of stray finger bones making up a partial hand, a deformed jawbone, and a few small skull fragments. These bones were scattered broadly across the excavated area, and there is no way of knowing if the bones even belong together. In fact, two of the finger bones turned out to be from a monkey that was mistakenly included. Oh, fancy that, eh? What was thought to be a third finger bone was actually a vertebra fragment. So in here, you can go through. There's a bunch of different stuff. Actually, there was one slide here that I wanted to go to. Right here. Virtually all of the bones attributed to Habilis were found as isolated bones or bone fragments. None of the bones were found physically connected to other bones. This means that paleo experts cannot reliably reconstruct even a partial Habilis skeleton. Even skull reconstructions are highly questionable. These bones were found in mixed bone beds containing many animal species. And this is frequent, actually, opening the door to accidentally combining ape and human bones into a chimeric species, in other words, a false taxon. Under such conditions, it is arguably impossible to know for certain which bones belong to which individual or species. That's why, like Brother Neff was saying earlier, you can find certain bones. Most of the bones with Habilis can easily be attributed to an Australopithecine. While you've also got some that are mixed, you've seen earlier, they mistaken some monkey bones, and you oftentimes get a human bone mixed in too. That's why Christopher Roop was talking about earlier that you've got these different groups of paleo experts that would emphasize certain bones that look ape and other bones that look humans. And especially when it comes to like the Lucy species and some of your Australopithecine species, they're going to emphasize the ones that look ape and say that they were tree dwelling. And then they'll look at the ones that look more human. And then they'll say that they were terrestrial, when in fact, they are just mixed bones found in these mixed bone beds. So right here, the bones of Handyman, isolated and fragmentary. The first bones attributed to Habilis, okay, in their first specimen there, it is the defining. So in their defining specimen,
You can find actually pictures of it on the internet, but Mary Leakey and her son, they found the bones in 1960, but like I said, they the specimen consisted of a broken and deformed lower jawbone with 13 teeth in place, an isolated molar, two small skull fragments, 21 finger hand and wrist bone. So you can see here, it's pitiful, you know, pitifully a few bones. I think Christopher Roop was saying is less than 20%. And like it says here, the ongoing controversy, it's very controversial surrounding Habilis, is in part because of what? The fragmented and incomplete nature of the bones. Habilis was established as a species based on its holotype, which in other words is the defining specimen that we went over earlier, the type specimen. It is the standard from which all subsequent discoveries are compared to in order to identify whether or not they belong to the same species. In other words, the defining specimen is critical to establishing the legitimacy of any hominin species. Paleo experts understand this. And what's funny is you've seen how pathetic that type specimen was. There's one other part I wanted to cover here first. So right here, a couple of paleo experts, Schwartz and Tattersall, they've emphasized the fact that the inclusion in Homo of the Homo habilis fossils so broadened the morphology of the genus that further hominids from other sites could be shoehorned into it, almost without regard to their physical appearance. As a result, the largely unexamined definition of Homo became even murkier. Remember earlier I was showing a paper how it's less clear, it's not any more concise, it's a bushy mess. Down here in this slide, it says habilis bones are often described as distorted, poorly preserved, scrappy, crushed, flattened, and broken into little pieces. Almost all of the skulls presumed to belong to habilis have been reconstructed more than once, with each new reconstruction calling into question earlier reconstructions. And also, as I continue, you can find all of this in Contested Bones, which is a fascinating book. And these specific slides are in a lecture series that I highly recommend. So here, many of the skull and facial remains were found severely crushed and flattened. Two of the skulls were washed into a gully and trampled by cattle. Reitmeier describes the challenges associated with trying to assess such fossils. And I don't have the quote here, but so it's right here. Last one I'll go over. Many other experts in the field have raised similar criticism. Habilis is simply too fragmentary. Now, I got to emphasize the fact, I'm sorry, it's just so funny how much time and emphasis they'll place on such fragmentary evidence, because as we showed over the last 2.5 hours, when it comes to the so-called prehumans or the obvious apes that we find that we have a lot of data for, including the genetics, it's so easy to know and to figure out if they're either human or if they are either ape. So here it says a morass of specimens that unrealistically broaden the Homo genus. The credibility of the ape-to-man story depends upon these bones. Yet after 50 years, nobody knows for sure whether Habilis is a real taxonomic entity or just a collection of random bone fragments. Paleo expert Tim White admits we still don't understand Habilis. So I'm going to say it's a desperate attempt when the evolutionists, they want to ignore the genetics, especially when it comes to determining ancestry, and they want to focus on that, which is so pathetic, so flimsy, so fragmentary. And you can find it being discussed right in the paleo literature. So yeah, I just wanted to cover those quotes and that data, and I'll hand it over to you, Neff, brother, if you want to finish it off. So maybe Neff. Oh, Neff, are you screen sharing something?
Yeah, there we go. Okay.
Well, what, so here I'm going to add. There you go.
Here we go. Homo habilis. The interesting thing about this is that a study has been conducted in computer analysis of the fossils. The best example they have of a skull of this creature, alleged creature, by Timothy Bromage, an anthropologist at New York University. And guess what? He discovered that the skull isn't right. as it was reconstructed by anthropologists. This is what it really should be looking like. His computer analysis reshapes the face of the animal so that it's far it protrudes far more than the way that it was reconstructed initially. Now, if Bromridge is right, and the indications are that he is going to be right, then this would place Homo habilis within make it an Australopithecine. In other words, it's there is no such thing as Homo habilis, as Standing for Truth pointed out. It's a made up taxonomy. It's completely fabricated. There probably is no such thing as Homo habilis. Here's some problems, 19 problems with the idea of Homo habilis. The species attributed to habilis vary widely, including the different measurements of the bone samples, which makes them very difficult to describe the accepted characteristics of the species. Because of this, evolutionists tend to describe the species that are generally accepted and belong to the taxa. In other words, they don't describe the individual, they describe the group. Because it's very difficult from the bone collection that they have to actually point to the features of an individual. A habilis is not a specific animal, but rather a conglomerate. Imagine species comprised of many bone fragments, which likely belong to several extinct apes. The type of specimen for Homo habilis consists of nearly a nearly complete left parietal bone, a fragmentary right parietal, and part of a mandible, including 13 teeth, an upper molar, and 21 hand bones. So that's all they have. They don't have a creature you can look at. The characteristics of the bone pieces vary enough from some evolutionists argue that they should be divided into a second species called Homo rudolfensis, while other evolutionists do not recognize rudolfensis as valid. Now, when Homo rudolfensis is referred to as a valid separate species by evolutionists, then they refer to Homo habilis as Homo habilis sensu stricto. So some evolutionists are attempting to divide the fossil, the bone fragments they have of this alleged creature, into two creatures, Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis, because that's the games evolutionists play with bones. When rudolfensis, I gave that information. If Timothy Bromridge is correct, then this creature will have to be reclassified as afarensis. So that just removes it from the taxonomy altogether. It disappears. Homo habilis, poof, gone. Doesn't even exist. Now, Lee Berger, who led a team that discovered Australopithecus sediba, criticized Leakey's team for not comparing the new fossils of Africanus in Australopithecus sediba and found in this same formation. A paleoanthropologist, Alan Walker, who was involved in the original reconstruction of this creature, said it looked like a big-brained Australopithecine, not any Homo habilis. Bernard Wood and Mark Collard have suggested that for the time being, Homo habilis and rudolfensis should be removed from the genus Homo and transferred to Australopithecine instead. Milford Wolperth, a paleontologist and professor of anthropology at University of Michigan, said that some scientists had used habilis as a garbage bag. In other words, fossils of extinct animals, which are difficult to determine as to belong to one taxa or another, are placed in this collection. It's a mishmash of bones that they attribute to Homo habilis, quote unquote. So there really is no species to speak of, Homo habilis. It's a collection of bones, and evolutionists can pick and choose from the bag what they want to make a creature and then put on display and say, look, this was your ancestor. Now, Tattersall and Schwartz have described the creature as a waste basket species into which a heterozygous variety of fossils could be conveniently swept. Kuhn and Clark listed several major morphological traits that they believe warrants its inclusion in as Australopithecus as well. So there's controversy over this creature. Postcranially, the creature looks more like Homo habilis than anything else. I mean, Australopithecines. So analysis of the creature demonstrates it should be included in the Australopithecines and not a separate taxon called Homo habilis. The most significant postcranial remains of the animal look completely like Australopithecines. And analysis of the limbs has been done that come to the same conclusions. So over and over, they keep finding controversy relating to this organism allegedly called Homo habilis. And it appears that really it's nothing more than a conglomerate of the imagination, a mishmash of bone shred pieces that the evolutionists can pick and choose from to create this creature a new taxonomy in their imagination. So, in truth, there probably is no such thing as Homo habilis. It's a mishmash of bone pieces that probably belong to several different extinct ape species, including afarensis, and never actually existed as an individual species. That's all.
Amen. You just knocked it out of the park there, Neff. I love where you said the evolutionists can pick and choose whatever they want from the bag. Bag of mixed bones and make bag whatever they want.
Of bones, you know, that's what it is. It's a collection of bones in drawers, and they go through the pieces and say, oh, I think that should go with that. And because in their mind, as they're putting the piece of the puzzle together, they're coming up with an ancestor of man from pieces that were just stuffed away in the drawers. And so since when evolution gets, you know, controversial and the evidence comes down hard against it, and they're running out of evidence for evolution to argue for because everything they're putting forth gets refuted. Well, they just say, look at that. Gee, nobody's talking about this bone fragment. I bet we could make a hominid out of that. That's the way it actually works.
It's sad. I love that. That was an amazing presentation. I'd love to see anybody. See, here's the thing. It's not going to stop them from still defending this pathetic bag of bones called habilis, which is why it's referred to as a waste basket,
garbage. Two different paleoanthropologists have called it. One called it a waste basket, another a garbage bag. In other words, just a mishmash collection of bones. Pick and choose which ones, and put together the puzzle, and make yourself a hominid.
Yep. It's like a game. They should open a theme park.
We need to create a creationist evolution game with little pictures, little puzzle pieces of different bones, and make yourself a hominid. And you just open the box and start putting them together like Legos, you know.
Hey, oh, Dad, I think you're on to something. I think you're on to something. Make yourself a hominin. Just like Lego, dump them out. Now you can see here we've got some ape-like bones. Over here we got some human-like bones. Right. You can mix them together if you want and make the perfect ape man. Or you can just make an ape, or you could just make a human, whatever you want. Right. It's when they find these bones, isolated, mixed, whatever. I mean, less than it's a sad, pathetic attempt at making an ape man. But that's what's so funny is that's what they now have to resort to is just the bottom of the barrel.
For a long time, because Homo habilis has been talked about in the journals for what, 30, 40, 50 years now.
Right.
Yeah, 40 years or more.
It's the highly fragmentary, you know, so-called fossils that are used when in fact, like you said, false taxon, artificial species, artificial construct. It's sad.
The public really needs to be aware of this. It's not like they go somewhere in Africa maybe and they dig up and they find a fossil of a creature, you know, an articulated fossil where the bones are all in place. That's not the way this works. The way it works is they dig up a skull fragment here, a foot away, or there's another skull fragment, 2 feet away, another one, 100 yards away, a couple more. Right. And over here is a finger bone. Wow, over there is a thigh bone. And I mean, over, and then they collect all this stuff. They don't know that they're not getting bone pieces from five different species of extinct apes. And that's exactly what they've likely done. Again, I mentioned that the it's been discovered. There's a, hey, Bob, you've got a baboon bone in that Lucy skull. What? Are you kidding? You know, so that's what they do. It's not like they dig up this creature and find it articulated in the dirt, in the rock. They don't do that. Instead, they find bone fragments, pieces of bones over a wide area, sometimes not even in the same vicinity, and in different strata. And this is what they put together and present to the public as an alleged ancestor of man.
Well, and remember too, they've got government grants, their livelihood, their careers depend on this. And all your paleo experts, you know, that's why you see Lee Berger oftentimes finding and discovering these. They all want to find the next big famous missing link. It's going to make them famous. And that's why they're oftentimes looking.
Who was it that was got embarrassed? What was it about a couple of years ago? Several years ago, it was he presented some fossil find of an alleged hominid, and he presented it to the world. And it was a big to-do. They had big photo shoot sessions of it and everything, and then they come to find out it was just an ape. What was it? Wasn't it just an ape? I can't remember the name of that, but it was.
Was it a lemur?
The guy. He ruined his career, probably.
Well, that's what's funny. And they wonder why the highly fragmented ones, the ones that are like less than 20% complete, they wonder why that in that waste basket of bones, they see what appears to be a curious assortment of Australopithecus and human-like characteristics, but they just won't put two and two together. But actually, a lot of paleo experts do put two and two together, which is why you can find quote after quote. I love this in Contested Bones, Dr. Sanford and Roop. They point out, they say, actually, most of the remains, they're talking about Sidiba on this occasion, were found in separate parts. Only a few of the bones were found in anatomically credible association. Yeah, so I want to point out, too, when you look at so-called transitional forms like Sidiba, what you'll find is anatomical contradictions, where it's not even like a mosaic assortment. It's almost like it's contradictory. It's not what you would typically expect in a transitional form if one were to exist. So it says that this site, you know, in this specific bone bed, this site consisted of a mixed bone bed of many different types of animals. Most of the bones were not found physically connected to one another. Thus, it is possible that Sidiba is not a legitimate species, but maybe a mixture of bones from more than one species, as was the case with Habilis. And what's funny is the baboon bone found with Lucy, it took 40 years to figure that out. So why don't you just wait another 40 years and you're going to find more and more. Like there were monkey bones that were mixed in with, you know, the Habilis taxon, the artificial species. So I just want to emphasize the fact to the critics, to the audience, you guys are going to have to find something better than just focusing on the most flimsy, the most pitiful so-called species out there that's just based on so few bones. Why? My question is why, when we have extensive evidence, when we have the genetic evidence, when we have the fossil evidence, why is it so easy to tell what's human and what's ask themselves that?
And why is it that they don't ever why is it that they don't ever dig in the earth and find an articulated fossil of one of these creatures?
Right.
They know, all of them are comprised of bone fragments that are found over a vast area in different strata and stuff. How come if there were hominids, why can't they dig in the earth and find a nearly complete fossil or even a largely complete fossil when we can dig in the earth and find a completely articulated dinosaur? And but we can't find
right. That's a beautiful point. Well, think about this when it comes to the fossils, Neff. Okay, let's assume they're a model for a second, okay? Let's say you've got Homo erectus who is evolving, okay? Let's say if you assume they're model, let's say they're on the planet
for about a million years. Let's say you've got about a million Homo erectus, okay? Let's put their average generation time between 20 and 30 years. What does this mean, Nev? This means there would be billions of dead bodies within that time frame that proponents of evolution would propose Homo erectus existed. Here's my question. Where are all the dead bodies? Because as you pointed out earlier, Neff, we could actually fit all the fossils. Let's just focus on erectus. We can fit all of the erectus fossils in the trunk of a car. Where are the billions of dead bodies? It looks like they never existed. That's because, you know, human evolution.
Where are the dead bodies? Exactly. I mean, where are the human bodies? If human beings have been Homo sapiens sapiens, as they claim, for a couple of hundred thousand years or more, how come there aren't, where's all the dead humans? And the evolutionist always comes back with, well, you know, there just weren't that many on the earth at one time. Because, you know, man wasn't surviving well and thriving with the early technology, you know, sticks and stones, and he, you know, riddled with disease, didn't have modern antibiotics. So the population was really small and they didn't have farming yet. So that's always their excuse. Well, there just wasn't a lot of them. But if you go over a period of hundreds of thousands of years, there would have had to have been, what, at least a few million of them. Right?
Right.
We should find more of this. Now, somebody asked a question. Does this also apply to habilis but not dinos? Well, dino fossils are found articulated. They're also found disarticulated. And then there's non-articulated fossils. Let me describe those three kinds for you. An articulated fossil means you find an organism and it's complete. All of its bones are right there because you have the whole thing. It died right there and fossilized right there, and you have them all. Then there's, or maybe not all of them, but you have a lot of them. A large percentage of the animal's bones are present. Or there's a disarticulated fossil, where in which you'll find that you'll find the bones of the organism, but not in the positions that those bones would have been in while the organism was living. Something has happened to cause its bones to be scattered around some. So that's called a disarticulated fossil. Its body parts have come apart by decay or scavenging and spread out a little bit, maybe a lot. So that's a disarticulated fossil. Then there's a non-articulated fossil, and that means you find you find a piece of, and this is what the habilis in other creatures typically are. You find not just the organism's bones in a close, in a small area, but they're not connected up like they would be when the animal was living. But we're talking about finding pieces of bone over a vast area, hundreds of yards apart, maybe a quarter of a mile or a mile and a half of area, and they find these different bone fragments and they put them together and say, look, this was that creature, when they can't possibly know it. That's what Homo habilis and Australopithecines are, is completely non-articulated fossils where the bones have been found in various places, hundreds of yards, if not thousands of yards away from each other. See, so you can have an organism die and get buried by the flood just like that and fossilize. His body parts are in the position that he was in when he was sealed in mud and became frozen in time, and he fossilized. You dig him up, you find the guy's bones, the animal's bones, all in the position they would normally be if the animal was living. Then you find, were disarticulated, where the bones have been spread around some, and they're not all connected up like the right ones, like they should be. And then completely non-articulated, where the bones are found over wide areas. That's what we find all three types, fossils of dinosaurs, and other creatures are found in all three types. But we do find articulated fossils of dinosaurs where nearly all, if not all, of the bones of the creature are in the ground, in the rock, in the position they would have been in while when the animal was buried in sediments and died immediately because he was buried in the flood. But we find none of these hominids, these alleged ancestors of man, are articulated. They're all non-articulated. In other words, they don't have a specimen. They don't dig up a specimen and say, there's a whole creature, or even 80% or 70% of one. Instead, what they find is a bone fragment here, 100 yards away is another one, but deeper in the strata. Then over here is another one, half a mile away is that one, 50 yards away is a different one. And they collect all these and they fabricate a species out of it. That's what we actually find when it comes to these hominids. Thought I'd clarify that for people.
Well, that's a brilliant answer, and I'm glad that it was asked and you addressed it, because this was Erika who, you know, would claim that this is her expertise, right? So she gets quite triggered when we point out the pathetically fragmented nature of the so-called best hominins, and then the fact that everything else we see in terms of the hominins fits perfectly with the biblical creation model. Her other argument is this, Neff. I'd be curious your thoughts. I find it kind of funny. We kind of addressed it earlier. She'll say, okay, yeah, oftentimes you'll find, you know, a piece of bone here and then a piece of bone way over here, let's say a scapula. But lo and behold, when you bring them together, they fit. So we should assume that they belong together. They belong as the same species. What would be your response to that, would you say, brother?
I'm sorry, Staying for Truth. My cat was driving me bad. Summarize what you just said. I'm sorry.
No problem. So the argument would be, okay, fine. You know, they are fragmented. Okay. Yeah. But we'll find, you know, this piece of, let's say, a scapula over here, another piece of scapula way over here, not even close together, you know, because it is sad how disarticulated they are. But then they'll say, well, but if we can piece it together, they fit together, you know, kind of like a puzzle or a Lego, then it must belong to the same species.
Yeah.
Is that the assumption?
There are likely dozens and dozens of species of completely extinct apes that once lived on the earth that are not with us anymore. Some of those species died in the flood, probably. The only example left of them would have been on the ark. They were an example of their kind on the ark. And some of those species didn't simply, like many, haven't made it to the present. They've gone extinct. We see animals go extinct all the time. One species or another goes extinct from this world, and it's in the news every other year. It seems like there's a new write-up in the news that a species is on the brink of or has gone extinct. So there are many, likely quite a few species of ape that are now extinct that the evolutionist would look at and say looks like a hominid. You know how stocky a gorilla is.
Right.
How stocky a chimpanzee is. And you look how.
Well, even just different stages of their life, like you were saying. An early chimpanzee, mm-hmm. you know, in its early years versus its adult years.
There's
some pretty significant changes there. You know, found in the fossil record, you might not even conclude that it's that the same chimpanzee, you know, the same species, when in fact it's just the same ape in different stages of its life. So I just wanted to throw that in there.
Continue. Yeah, that could be, especially the shape of the face of an ape changes dramatically as it ages. A newborn chimpanzee has a very flattish face, looks almost human-esque. But by the time they're 12 or 15 years old, their muzzle, their mouth and nose protrudes wildly, way out front. And so their shape of their head, their face changes dramatically during as they age. Now I lost my
chain of thought. What was it we're talking about? You'd find such an incredible variation in
Extinct. Yeah. So look how stocky a chimpanzee or a gorilla is, right? But and look how slender and slim some species of monkey are, though. They look real skinny. You know, they're not muscular and stocky, right? It's very likely, I think, that there were apes on the earth that were slender but large, like a gorilla is large. In the past, they're now extinct. Now, evolutionists would straighten that guy up, make him stand upright and say, oh, that's a human-looking thing. He's got to be a close ancestor of ours. But not necessarily. Maybe he's just an extinct ape that looked, that was slim, big like a chimpanzee, or orangutan, or a gorilla, maybe bigger than that even, but was not stocky and thick like a gorilla or a chimpanzee is, maybe a more slender type of ape. That, imagine a giant spider monkey, for example. Instead of being a little guy that could sit on your shoulder, this guy is 4 feet tall when he, or 5 feet tall when he stands upright. But he's built structurally like a spider monkey. There were probably apes that existed immediately after the flood that got off the ark like that. None of such ape exists today, though. So an evolutionist could find bones for a creature like that that is now extinct, and because of the slender shape of this creature and its height, they would take these bones and they would declare them to be that of an ancestor of man when they're nothing but an extinct species of ape.
Well, and I like what you said there, because I want to point out the fact that we would expect a lot of diversity in the pre-flood world and even immediately after the flood. And what we see today is your ape species, like chimpanzees, have more diversity within themselves than humans and Neanderthals do, you know, and the evolutionist wants to say that Neanderthals are a subspecies. But point is, there's a lot of genetic diversity in these ape species. Therefore, if it was even more so in the past, then you're right. You can find all of these different bones and make all sorts of conclusions. And that's why oftentimes you do get what results is anatomical contradictions, because you are taking a mixture of different species, of different bones, and putting them together to say it's, you know, a single species, when in fact it is the result of multiple species. So that is a good, and because there's so many similarities between humans and the other apes, okay, you know, we share the most in morphology and anatomy with the apes. Therefore, if you, what we do find is a lot of homo bones and ape bones mixed together. But because we share the most in terms of anatomy and morphology with the apes, it's a lot easier to result in artificial species. You know, you're not going to take a dog bone and accidentally build an artificial species with human bones, but with apes, because we share so much with them to begin with, makes sense.
Right. Our skeletons are very similar. And another thing is that we have, we know of for sure that there have been four species of great ape on the earth: the chimpanzee, the gorilla, and orangutans, and then there's Gigantopithecus, which we're not really sure what it was, except that it was an ape, and it was really, really big, standing 10 to 12 feet tall, upright. It would have been 10 to 12 feet tall, judging by the calculations based on the size of this jaw bone that they found. This would have been one big ape, really, really big. So we know there's been four, at least, species of great ape. But why only four? Why couldn't there have been nine or 10 great ape species that got off the ark, and we only have three of them left today? The rest have gone extinct. I think that's very plausible. In fact, I think it's almost, I think it's probable that there were other species of apes that were large, would be classified as a great ape today by today's anthropologists, but and paleontologists, but they're simply extinct today. So that just gives more bones to the of unknown creatures,
right?
Mishmash, yeah, to be put into the garbage bag.
Yeah, when you unload that garbage bag of mixed bones for multiple different species, you can make up any story that you want. And this is why this phylogeny right here, as you can see, I took this from Contested Bones, but it illustrates it perfectly that when we have nearly the full data, okay, when it comes to these so-called hominins, we can easily classify, as you can see here, humans, the humankind, Erectus, Neanderthalensis, Denisovans, Hobbits, Naledi. I would put Luzonensis in there as a newer fossil discovery. So easy.
just based on the fossil evidence, the morphology, anatomy, genetics, and same thing with your gorilla-like ancestor, chimp-like, orangutan, australopith, easy to conclude, easy to build a phylogeny. And if you notice, what's left out would be your false taxon, your waste basket species, like your habilis, which is just pathetic, and your sediba. So that's the question. We've asked it, you know, five times. It's like when the evidence is there, the data is there, the conclusion is easy. Only when we're looking at highly fragmentary data does it become confusing.
Right. And the thing that makes this all possible for the evolutionists is that these are unarticulated fossils. So I thought of a way to revise our little evolutionist game. Make yourself a hominid. We sell it in a little plastic bag, and it'll contain little plastic bone pieces, and different. There'll be more than one type of femur in there. There'll be more than one humerus, you know, and stuff. And they can pick and say, "Well, I like that fit. That one goes there better." No. Well, I like this one for a thigh. That's going to be my thigh. You pick a thigh yet? I think I'll pick that thigh. And they could just little plastic bones. You know, you open the bag. It has a drawstring, right? And you pull it open and you dump the little plastic bone bits out on the carpet and have yourself an afternoon building yourself a hominid.
Build yourself a hominid. Come see Nap and Standing for Truth.
Yeah. $9.95 at Toys R Us, you know.
That's what I think. I think one of the main requirements to work in that field of paleo anthropology is to have an amazing imagination. Because of the highly fragmented nature of the bones, you have to. You have to be good at storyboards.
Sure, and a lot of these bones are not even complete bones. They're parts of a bone. You know, they're not a whole femur, but, you know, a portion of a femur bone. You know, rarely do they actually find a whole bone, in fact. It's not like they find a whole articulated fossil. They don't need much. It's even worse than that. They don't often find an entire femur or tibula. It's pieces of tibulas and femurs. And there's gaps in between them. We think this is obviously the top part of a femur, and this part's the bottom part. We're missing the middle part. But I think A goes with B. What do you think, George?
That's how they do it. Isn't it pathetic that we have all of this amazing genetic data now to help us determine ancestry? And then you got these people who spend their lives. I mean, I got my dog in the backyard, you know, digging up bones, for example. You got these people spending their lives on such highly flimsy evidence. This is why I want to point out Sediba. This is a prime example of it. This is why you'll find Sediba's rib cage is clearly ape. Okay, you were pointing to the skull and ape features there. Sediba's upper limbs are ape. But then, remember I was speaking of contradictory anatomy, anatomical contradictory? Then you got Sediba's hand, which is like identical to a human hand today. But this is funny. I'm going to take this from Contested Bones. It says, the perfectly human hand of Sediba is incompatible, okay, incompatible with the distinctly ape-like anatomy of the upper limbs. If Sediba swung through the trees, it could not do so with human hands. You know, can you even just picture that? So, and this is what I mean by contradictory nature of these artificial taxa. You know, it just doesn't make any sense. It's sad. So, Sediba right here, like you said, Sediba's skull and brain case are ape. You touched on that earlier, right, brother? Sediba?
Sediba? I did. I mentioned that I created a rebuttal to the Ardipithecus sediba fossil video. I did that probably 6-7 years ago, I think.
Yeah, and you pointed to the skull of sediba.
Oh yeah, the way they depicted it on the cover of Smithsonian magazine, I believe, with the skull turned at an angle to make the face look flatter, but in doing so, they had the eyeballs pointing down towards the ground instead of horizontal with a horizon, which is the way that you would use to turn the skull. So the eyes are eye sockets are level with the horizon. So then you can properly determine what is the actual slant of the face. the frontals, and but they in their attempt to make the creature look more human tilted the thing by what I figured was 16 degrees because I rotated it 16 degrees, and that's when I got the eye sockets to be level with the horizon. So they rotated its skull by about 16 degrees to make it look more human, so the public will buy into it more.
Yeah. It's well, exactly, because it's a lot of indoctrination. It's a lot of showcasing. That's why a lot of the evidence.
Subtle tricks, true. Subtle tricks.
A lot of the show, especially with the kids, that's where they get them. That's why you won't find an entire unit on what we discussed today. All the numbers of lines of evidence that suggest the Australopithecines and the Homo genus, humans coexisted, intermingled. You know, there's even evidence that suggests that humans ate some of the Australopithecines, kind of like today, you know, some humans eat monkeys. I never would, but the evidence is there. So it's just funny how consistent that fact would be with, you know, biblical creation, but you don't hear them talk about it. Why not? Right. Because it downplays the theory. It doesn't make it look as good anymore that we're living with our ancestors, you know, our so-called ancestors.
Right. Creationists need to keep this in mind. Anybody who's involved in a discussion with an evolutionist and they immediately, and they start talking about anthropology, paleontology, and they start talking about alleged hominid fossils, ask them, is that an articulated fossil, a disarticulated fossil, or a non-articulated fossil? And if they say, well, I don't know what that means, explain to them what that means and ask them, were these bone pieces found over a large area of ground and in different strata? These pieces that, and if they say, well, yeah, but we know by studying those pieces that they were the same species, I say, good for you. Now, you believe that. You go ahead and believe that you know that you have all the bone pieces that, or some portion of the bone pieces that make a given species. When you can demonstrate that those bones are not comprised of several different species of ape that are extinct and actually go together because they were found over a vast area and they were found in different strata, then you'll have something to talk about. Till then, any imagined, alleged fossil hominid that you have is in a garbage bag and it's a mix mash, and you're not going to be able to use it as evidence for evolution. You can just dismiss hominids altogether. It's too easy. Just ask them, is that a disarticulated fossil where it's bone pieces found over a vast area of ground in different strata? If the answer to that question is yes, then you say, you have no hominid to show me. Dig one up and find 80% of the creature's bones all in one place in the position they would have been or nearly would have been in when the creature died, and we'll have something to talk about.
Exactly. and that's why, you know, they have to, like, for example, Aron, you know, he'll never be able to respond to really any of this video. The genetic data is just, it's gonna have to go in one ear and out the other because it conflicts with his worldview, and all they have left is this, you know, in the corner, you know, this mixed bone bag, right. And that's it. And it's just it's a sad state of affairs. So I want to point out the fact that we've been going for almost 4 hours. We still have 33 people in the chat. So I want to thank everybody for sticking it out. I think we spent, you know, over 3.5 hours on a 10-minute Aron Ra video. And we know Aaron's got a lot of videos out there. So we've got job security. But I wanted to, you know, thank everybody for being here. I think this was all the challenges out there. You know, we challenge any of these guys to respond or just debate us if they, you know, feel like they don't want to respond, but they could. Well, debate us then. So Matt and Neff, Jason, I think, is asleep. But if you guys had any final words, I'm getting pretty tired and I got to be up in 4 hours. So I think I'm going to shut her down. The floor is yours for some final words if you'd like.
No, if you got 4 hours to go, I'm out. I'm good.
A 4-hour stream and then 4 hours sleep. I love coffee though, like Neff, so I'll be fine. Man. Final words, brother Neff?
No final words. I think we all did a great job of exposing the failure of evolutionists like Aron Ra.
And I want to tell the audience, we got a lot to look forward to. We've got Dr. Rob Stadler. Actually, what a coincidence. Dessel just asked. He'll be here Friday. We're going to debunk Professor Dave. Monday, Dr. Rob Carter. We are pumped. Rob, Adam, and myself are going to be asking him some good questions on Adam and Eve, biblical creation, young earth creation science. A couple debates as well scheduled. And Neff and I
we're getting ready for another round kind of similar to this, where we are going to demolish Tiktaalik and some other transitional forms. So like I said, guys, this is our second episode of this series. The first one, we demolished Vice Rhino. Definitely check out the Refuting the Critics playlist we have. And we've got a ton of videos we're looking forward to doing the exact same thing too that we did tonight. So if anyone has specific videos they've seen they want us to refute, we'll do it. So we'll do this every week. Neff, I know you're always available on the weekends, right, brother?
Yeah, we're available almost only on weekends, pretty much. And that's something started up real early in the evening, and I know that that doesn't work for you because of your schedule. So yeah, you can catch me most weekends. I can make myself available most weekends.
Okay. Well, we got a lot of videos to do. This is going to be a lot of fun, so we'll stay in touch. But yeah, this was great. I want to thank everybody involved tonight with their slides, presentations, visuals. We definitely have our critics definitely have a lot to address. So
I'll find us an investor so we can start making build yourself a hominid toys.
It'll be perfect, right in time for Christmas. All parents will be buying it for their kids.
Yeah.
Build yourself a Sediba and a Habilis.
Yeah. Give it a new name. No.
Yeah.
Yeah. Name it
after give it a new name. Why recycle these names?
Australia Pethicus Joni.
Unlimited fun.
Yeah.
For only $25, you can have your own waste basket.
You can make your own hominid. Yeah, and publish it in your own.
You'll never guess. We got some monkey bones over here, some ape bones over here, some human bones. Heck, we even stuck a dog bone in there.
Yeah, why not?
Okay, so what I'll do is I'm going to end it here, especially for, once again, thanks to the chat. We've had a good audience all night. I'm going to end it with our another evolutionist bites the dust. Aron really bit the dust tonight. So I'm going to end it with the trailer and call it a night. Thanks again, guys. Standing for Truth is out.
Another one bites the dust. Hey, gonna get you too. Another one bites the dust.